A very good morning and welcome to the first meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. And I'd like to wish everyone a very happy new year. So we have apologies noted this morning from Pauline McNeill. And our first item of business today is an oral evidence session on the Bail and Release from Custody Scotland Bill, which will be our main item of business over the next few weeks. And we've got two panels joining us today. Our first panel is Kate Wallace from Victim Support Scotland and Ms Emma Bryson from Speak Out Survivors. So welcome to you both. And I refer members to papers one and two. I intend to allow about 60 minutes for the session, and as ever, I would appreciate fairly succinct questions and responses. So as time is quite tight, I'd like to move straight into questions and open up with a very general question, if I may. And I'll come to you first, Kate. So we thank you for the submission that Victim Support Scotland provided the committee. And in your submission, you set out your sort of general concerns about the proposed provisions in relation to the use of bail and remand. So I'm just wondering if you can update members on the details of your concerns, particularly around the new test, and then I'll maybe come to Emma and bring you in on that. So, Kate.
So, yeah, I mean, I think, in summary, you know, we recognise that remand, the proportion of people who are on remand has increased. We think it's really important to remember what the purpose of remand is, though. It's really important in terms of public and individuals, so individual victims and complainers' safety. And we are concerned that robust risk assessment has to take place in order to make sure that victims and complainers and public safety remains paramount. So in essence, that is you know, what we've been discussing and making sure that robust risk assessment, adequate resources are in place, the right information is shared with the right organisations, and risk assessments carried out by trained professionals with and also, ultimately, the right resources to supervise, monitor and support those individuals in the community. So I think that really summarises it.
Mm-hmm. OK, thanks very much. I'll come in with a follow-up question in a moment, but I'd just like to bring in Emma and pick up on the same question, if you would.
So I'd like to start by saying, first of all, that I'm a representative of a very small organisation, and we are three people working in a voluntary capacity, so we don't have the resources to carry out large amounts of research. What we do bring to the table, though, is the lived experience and the best interests, we believe, of victims and survivors, specifically of sexual and domestic offences, but kind of more broadly anyone who's been the victim of crime. And I think really I would echo much of what Kate's just said. You know, we know anecdotally from, you know, many of the people that we support and represent that when it comes to bail conditions, that the concerns and the experiences of victims are often not adequately considered, that we have concerns about the frequency with which bail conditions are breached and the ongoing impact that has on victims of offences as well.
Thanks very much. So if I can maybe pick up before handing over to other members on the risk assessment process that you've outlined, Kate, and that you would obviously, or Victim Support Scotland would want to see as part of the consideration process. Obviously, within the bill, the proposal is that criminal justice social work have a big role in informing bail decisions. I'm interested in your views on who else or which other organisations it would be appropriate to have participate in that process, particularly given the concerns that you've outlined for victims and the importance of their voice being heard in that decision-making process.
Yeah, so, you know, our concerns would be making sure that that risk assessment does consider the safety of the public, victims and complainers, as paramount, and to do that, it has the right information, the access to the right information from the right organisations, and that would include organisations that support victims currently. that does not routinely happen, as I'm sure you're aware at the moment. So we believe that's really, really important, and that risk assessments carried out by trained individuals. Yes, it will be challenging around the timescales for this, but given the profile of people who are currently on remand, the proportion increase in remand is not driven evenly across all crime types. It's driven very much by people who are on remand accused of sexual offences and violent offences, as you know. And also when you look at the figures for conviction of crimes whilst people are on bail, there are a significant number of people who are convicted of crimes whilst on bail. 11 people, for example, in 1 year were convicted of murder or culpable homicide, and over 70 people were convicted of rape, sexual assault and other sexual crimes too. So that risk assessment process is really important, and it's really important to include the experiences and insights from victims themselves.
Okay, thank you for that. Emma, would you like to come in on that?
Yeah, I think certainly with regard to risk assessments, that the experiences of victims are often, as I said previously, not adequately considered. I think what we would say is that nobody is better placed to understand the specific risk posed by a particular offender than the person who's been the victim of their offending. And I think that's especially true of domestic abuse, which is, you know, it can be difficult to prosecute due to the nature of the offence, you know, offences that happen behind closed doors, and the same is true of sexual offences. We know sort of victims who have been affected by domestic and sexual offences where the offender is on bail. You know, we hear over and over again how when bail conditions are breached, that they are not necessarily acted upon. There seems to be quite a gulf between the theory of what constitutes a breach of bail and how that's supposed to be responded to, and how that is implemented in practice, which can be really, really disheartening for victims, and can cause many of them to, you know, to kind of disengage with the process, to, you know, to withdraw complaints, because they just feel like they are continually being re-traumatised by a process that hasn't fully understood their, you know, not just the harm that they may have experienced, but the ongoing kind of psychological impact it has upon them. And we would like to see that taken account of more. And, you know, we certainly recognise, we welcome the fact that it's been recognised, the psychological element is recognised by the committee, but we would like to see kind of further sort of specific focus on this in terms of how you respond to that and how you implement safeguards there.
Okay, thanks very much both. I mean, there's a lot in that, and lots of follow-up questions that we can ask, but I'm just going to bring in other members now, and I'm going to hand over to Russell Finlay.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. The intent behind this bill is to reduce remand and therefore increase the number of people getting bail. We already know that 1 in 8 crimes are committed by those who are on bail. And in your submission on page 6, you say, a direct quote, "The unfortunate reality of more individuals being released on bail that would otherwise be remanded will mean an increase of individuals who commit crimes whilst on bail." We'll also hear later from some academics who address the same point in their written submission, and they say that... let me just find this. Excuse me. That bail reform, quote, "need not be causally associated with increases in crime." Can you perhaps explain a bit further on that? There does seem to be a bit of a contradiction there. On the one hand, victims' organisations are saying more bail equals more crime, and the data that already exists seems to suggest that's the case. Some of this academic research or opinion appears to suggest otherwise. Can you explain a bit more?
At the moment, you've got a significant number of people, as you've said, who are convicted for other offences whilst on bail, without any change to what is put in place around bail and supervision, monitoring, management, support, to then yes, those the logic tells you that the there will be more people put at risk, there will be more victims of crime, and there will be more lives ruined. However, there is an opportunity to change and this, what goes in around bail in terms of supervision, management, monitoring. It will require a significant amount of resource. It will require a significant amount of different types of approaches that appear to me that we don't currently have in Scotland. You know, the scale of people who are convicted on offences whilst on bail tells you that there's not what is happening on bail is not working currently. So you know, but there is, and I think that's what the difference is between those two statements is with a different approach to bail supervision. Services for people with complex needs, closer management and monitoring and supervision, then it perhaps need not be inevitable. However, those services currently do not exist, and we're in a situation where we're under huge pressure around resources across the country, across all areas.
Existing crimes that occur while people are on bail need not happen in a reformed, fully reformed system across the board. Is that a kind of fair
potentially
assessment?
And with robust risk assessment based on ensuring that bail is considered only when we can be absolutely certain that people are not going to be put at risk, and where there's absolute certainty around adequate management and supervision within the community.
Thank you. There's another issue I could pick up on just now. Is that okay, or do we have time? Or?
Is it only two?
It's about the electronic monitoring as time served.
Yeah, okay. And then I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay.
Thank you very much. So on page 7 of your submission, it says time spent in electronic monitoring should be no substitute for time that would have been spent in prison as part of a sentence. And again, turning to the submission from the academics, they suggest that the amount of time, it would be reasonable to treat 2 days spent on electronic monitoring as the equivalent of 1 day in custody at the time of sentencing. Is that a formula or a suggestion you've come across before, and is that one that you agree with?
It's not one that we would agree with, no. They're two completely different things. And a custodial sentence is completely different from electronic monitoring at home. So we would continue to disagree with others on that.
So if an individual is bailed but subject to electronic monitoring and then it comes the time of sentencing, no real consideration should be given to the restrictions they were under at the time prior
consideration, to? Yes, but reducing time spent in custody because of the time in electronic monitoring, then no.
Is that partly ideological but partly also because you do have offenders who play the system and prolong proceedings, as we know, churn cases, and that could be considered a softer way of doing time?
I guess my response to that would be that they are two completely different things and therefore should be treated as such. And I would leave it at that.
And if you care to answer, you can, but that seems to be reasonable. So thank you.
Okay. Rona Mackay, bring you in.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Kate and Emma. I wanted to go back a bit to something you talked about earlier about the removal of restrictions on bail in solemn cases. And from your submission, I know that you oppose the repeal of Section 23D, and you know, which means that it would be the same test for all offences. And you talked about sexual violence and domestic abuse. So I wonder if you could maybe just expand a wee bit on that. Tell us what your opposition, your fears are about it, and what, you know, whether you would just like to see these exceptions remain rather than be repealed. So Emma, can I come to you first?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, I think when it comes to repealing Section 23D legislation, we have concerns about that. I mean, our understanding is that was specifically implemented to address violence, crimes that involve violence against women and girls. And we would really want to see something, sort of legislation replacing that offers again that specific protection, to those types of offences. again, you know, to go back to the point that, you know, we fully recognise that domestic and sexual offences are the hardest to prosecute and hardest to, you know, in terms of victim welfare. We feel it's all the more important that any legislation that in place is robust enough to recognise those very specific risks and harms they face.
And Kate, that from the victim's point of view, would this cause some alarm if this was repealed and they felt, well, we're just being treated the same as every other offence, despite the kind of almost unique nature of domestic abuse and sexual offences?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So we agree. We think those exemptions should remain.
And any changes to what's there at the moment? Do you want to strengthen the exceptions, or are you happy that there are exceptions at the minute?
We'd need to come back to you on that. I don't think we'd considered that.
That's fine. That's fine, Convener. Thank you.
Fulton, I think you want to come in.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. Tamer and Kate, good to see you both. Kate, you'd mentioned earlier there about the systems that would need to be in place around bail if this was going to work. And I think that is probably the crux of this legislation. If we're going to be serious about reducing our numbers in remand, what we don't want to do, which I think you've both articulated, is put people more at risk because there's not robust safeguards around. Do you have any... are you able to tell us what you think that might look like? What bits of the bill do you think are good in that, or do you think we need to go a bit further? How do you think that system might look around people who are on bail?
Well, from our perspective, obviously I'm here representing an organisation that supports victims of crime. So from a victim's perspective, what needs to happen, which is not currently happening, is better communication with victims about bail conditions, and victims need to be satisfied that there is a robust system around and managing an individual within the community in a way that that's not their experience at the moment. So gathering information from victims to inform risk assessments, updating victims about bail conditions and letting them know and understand what that means. One of the other points I was going to make is that the area around judges and sheriffs having to explain why remand is used. We also think that bail should be explained as well in terms of reasons, and that would be helpful for victims and others too. So given consideration to that, to make sure that those reasons are given, and also any changes, so a clear understanding about what happens when breaches, and where that information goes, because at the moment the experience of victims is that is extremely patchy. The victims often feel as though they're the people who have to police the bail conditions themselves. They often don't know what they are. They're often not given an opportunity to contest those bail conditions, even in situations where it's making them or their children unsafe. So from a victim's perspective, I can answer that question. I think there will be other people who will be able to answer that question better in terms of the mechanisms that should be in and around the accused persons who would potentially otherwise be on remand. But for us, it would be about transparency, support going in to victims, gathering information, sharing that information, and absolutely a robust set of measures around, which means that victims and the public are kept safe.
Yeah, and I'll come to yourself in a minute, Emma, as well, but I wonder how you think we might achieve that. If I go back to the provisions in the bill around input from justice social work, which I know you'll be aware of, and it's a big part of the bill. Do you think there's anything in there that perhaps at that stage, through these provisions, justice social workers could be bringing in agencies like yourself or others, Women's Aid and other organisations that might be working with victims? Is that the way in? I don't think that could be made, you know, a statutory duty, if you like, but is it something that could be developed in practice? What You know, is that a thought of how that what you've outlined there in a general sense could be achieved?
Yeah, we would agree with that. That gathering information from victims themselves and complainers and victims' organisations and feeding that information in through criminal justice, social work, and the way that happens in other countries should be done more routinely in Scotland, absolutely. And it's, don't get me wrong, it's not without its challenge, I know that. But that's a piece of the puzzle, certainly, that's missing at the moment and would be more helpful. There are, you know, we've got examples of, you know, bail conditions that have not had any due regard to, you know, for example, where victims reside and contact arrangements with children, that type of stuff that's putting people at further risk. So that would certainly help alleviate some of those issues, I think.
Thanks. Emma, have you got anything on this particular?
Yeah, I think, I mean, again, I'd echo much of what Kate just said. I mean, from our perspective, you know, we hear time and time again from victims where the offender's on bail, that they are not informed, you know, especially in a timely fashion when... you know, when an offender has been released, they quite often, or the information isn't given to them until after the fact, so they have no opportunity to prepare for it, no opportunity to, you know, kind of put their own sort of safeguarding measures in place if they feel at risk. What we hear again repeatedly is that victims feel that their concerns, their specific concerns about the specific offenders, are not taken into consideration. And, you know, I would just reiterate the point that nobody's better placed to understand the risk they face than, you know, than the victim who's already been through that process. You know, victims' experiences aren't, you know, a kind of a homogenous entity. They don't fall neatly into, you know, kind of very sort of closed categories. I think that, I think you certainly made reference to kind of a holistic approach in your written submission, and we would all heartedly agree with that. And again, when it comes to victims' experiences, you know, there is that a gap sometimes between the theory of what should happen when bail conditions are breached and what actually happens. We, you know, we have one particular person who we supported who, when the bail conditions were breached by the offender approaching this woman in a public place, she was advised by the police that she ought to stay out of his way. And that, you know, that's not how bail conditions are supposed to work.
I think it's a similar question that I gave to Kate, but maybe digging in a wee bit more. Do you think that part of this provision around the powers for justice social work would be about, if there is, because it might not always be the case, but if there is a specific victim or specific victims, because this is the area that you obviously deal with, that assessment needs to address, you know, the plans around how that person or persons can be kept safe? Does that make sense?
I think so. Yeah. Because I think that, you know, often, and understandably, you know, you can't tailor a plan for every individual victim. But the idea that that risk factors, you know, I think it's quite often treated as a bit of a box-ticking exercise and doesn't always take regard of specific risk factors, you know. And again, you know, I keep coming back to domestic and sexual offences because these are the hardest, you know, these are the most difficult cases to deal with. But they're also the cases where, you know, those victims suffer the most harm when, you know, bail is breached or when, you know, they're not informed in a timely fashion. You know, the psychological harm that they suffer ongoing, long term, you know, really can't be quantified.
Thanks both. Thanks, Gina.
OK, thank you very much. I might just come in. Sorry, Katie, I think you just...
Notchers Hall, I don't know if it's a good time to come
on
in or
you
not.
Go. I'll hand over to you.
Thank you very much. I was wanting to ask, you'll be aware that in the legislation that's proposed, there's a new concept that's being brought in of public safety, which isn't something that the criminal courts have dealt with before. And there is concern that there will be a lack of clarity round about that, perhaps lots of court appeals, you know, arguing about what that concept means, and that it might be helpful if it was better defined within the bill. I wonder if perhaps if I come to Kate first, whether you think the introduction of this concept is helpful and how you think that would be better defined. What have you got any thoughts on that? If asked that, and then I've got a supplementary question.
So we do think it's helpful, and we also think it's helpful that it mentions not only public safety but individual complainers or victim safety too, because often when public safety is thought about. It's thought about more generally rather than potentially some of the individual complainers themselves. So, for example, thinking like a crime like stalking. I think it's really useful to have both of those things included. Having it more clearly defined may be more beneficial. I think it's, you know, it comes back to that point around risk assessment and having a robust risk assessment, and you'll be taking evidence, I believe, in a couple of weeks' time from the Risk Management Authority, where I'm sure they will have a view about that. But I think, yeah, it's being clear about harm and being clear about the type of harm, and as Emma's said, being clear around psychological as well as physical harm being included in that definition, I think is helpful. So yeah, I mean that's our view about that, that having, because that, you know, it's about remembering what the purpose of remand is and not losing sight of that. And one of the main purposes, it seems to us, that's potentially strengthened within this bill is around public and complainer and victim safety.
A greater emphasis on complainers. And could you maybe say when you think it might be appropriate to remand a person who's accused of a non-violent offence? You've spoken about sexual offences and violent offences, but in terms of non-violent offences, do you think there's situations where remand is appropriate?
I think there'll be others who are better placed to answer around that. Our view is that remand has a really clear purpose around the protection of the public and victims and complainers, and that having a primary use around that is helpful. You know, we could, depending on how you define, I guess, different types of crimes, but certainly if we keep that in our minds, there'll be others who could potentially argue around the repeat nature and all the rest of it. And I think the other thing to remember as well is that in some crimes, index offences, you'll all know this in the committee, it's often, particularly in cases of domestic abuse and others, some of the index offences are shielding a type of offending behaviour that is indicating individuals may be potentially at risk. So, for example, breach of the peace has got such a massive kind of catch-all category and covers quite a wide range of different types of offending behaviour. So I think that's something potentially to bear in mind as well. And also the way that at times hate crime is defined wouldn't necessarily be sometimes a crime of violence, but that would be another one that I would potentially have a concern about too. So, but yeah, too much probably going into in this.
Could I ask Emma the same really? I mean, in terms of this concept of public safety, is that something that you've had the opportunity to look at? If it was to be better defined, what would your thoughts be on that? And are you concerned that if a new concept is brought in, that actually might make it more difficult for victims if there's a lack of certainty as to what the law is?
I mean, I think, you know, broadly, you know, we broadly welcome the idea of introducing this element of public safety, because ultimately, you know, from the sort of general public's point of view, that's absolutely what I think needs to be stated. You know, that is the purpose of it. I think that, again, the difference, I suppose, lies in, you know, when you're talking public safety, which is about keeping the general public, you know, safe from of various forms of harm, and then the safety of individual victims and complainers. And that's a very, very different kettle of fish altogether. And I think, you know, to refer to the difference between violent and non-violent crimes, I think that most people would agree that when you're talking about violent crimes, you know, they are recognisably more serious than non-violent crimes. But I think when you consider, and again to refer back to, you know, domestic offences, when you add coercive control into that mix, now that is something that is such a real insidious offence. It can be very difficult to define. It can be very difficult to identify. If you have, you know, a victim, you know, reporting coercive control to the police or, you know, to another organisation, the things that they are afraid of, you know, the actions of the offender that have placed them in a state of fear and alarm, can seem completely inconsequential to somebody outside of that relationship. And again, that's why I kind of, you know, I come back to the point about nobody is better placed to understand the risks they face than the people who have already, you know, and especially when you're talking non-violent crimes, which I think, you know, for many people, you know, you would automatically be considered as less serious, but actually, in many cases, can be more serious because the psychological harm that's inflicted, you know, it's not as easily remedied as, you know, a broken bone or a, you know, or you know, you know, kind of physical injuries.
Okay, thank you.
Very much, Colette. Do you want to come back in?
I was wanting to come in on release planning and ask about your submission. Thanks as well, Kate and Emma, for your submission. In terms of the new legislation coming forward, the aim is to support the successful reintegration of prisoners back into the community, and that includes release planning and also, you know, through care as well. Do you think that the proposals that are being put forward in the bill are helpful, and would you like to see any other changes to obviously reflect the interests of the victims, but also as well, have you seen any good practice in place, you know, in your own experience as well on that? If I could ask Kate first of all.
So, yeah, I mean, this committee's heard me talk about release planning before, and the example of emergency air release where there was no information sharing whatsoever with victim support organisations and victims to help prepare them for a situation where an offender was being released into the community, and the catastrophic impact that had across a wide range of organisations and individuals. So I think, you know, whilst we welcome the attempt in this bill as it's currently drafted, we do have, it's contingent upon a complete review of the victim notification scheme, and that those changes being implemented at pace, I would say. There are some intricacies of how information would be shared and how it could be shared and how that would work that we would want to work through in a bit more detail, I think. We welcome the attempt and to consider some of those issues in this bill, but we think there's further work to be done to make sure that actually works in practice the way I think it's attempting to be in terms of the drafting, I suppose. So one of the examples of that is, I think that at one point it says in the bill that information can be shared with victim support organisations regardless of whether or not a victim has agreed to that. Now, there may well be a very good reason for that, but there are other unintended consequences of sharing information with organisations where victims have not necessarily consented to that information being shared. And also our experiences of criminal justice agencies sharing information with third sector organisations is not good. So we would have concerns that actually in practice there would be quite a few barriers, particularly from organisations like Police Scotland, for example, than more than has been anticipated. So we would have to work through all of that, I think, to make that a reality. In terms of good practice, there are some examples in the Caledonian project, for example, around domestic abuse, where information is gathered from victims too, and they're an integral part of that programme. There's another domestic abuse organisation that has information shared with it on release and prior to release and bail, but the issue that we have with that is those are probably the only two examples that I can give you. It is in no way widespread across the whole country that type of approach that we would expect. From my perspective, what I would like to see is that, you know, I absolutely get the point around making sure that support and services are in place for people being released from custody, and that that happens quickly, and that there's they're ready there. that has to be mirrored for victims too. So that, you know, from a, you, we've got a justice strategy that talks about trauma-informed and person-centred approaches. To me, that means that we should be preparing people earlier, victims earlier, for people being released. We should have support in place for them prior, at the point of and after release, and there should be really clear mechanisms in place for sharing information, for example, when things go wrong. So ultimately, if those things are working in the way that I've just laid out, ideally you would end up with less victims then on an ongoing basis, and less people traumatised than has happened currently.
Okay, thanks. Emma, do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of this side of things isn't something that we have a great deal of knowledge or experience in, but I would like to make just a few comments. And again, you know, it's around victims being informed. You know, I'd completely agree with Kate in the point about information sharing being absolutely critical. And I think, you know, again, for victims who, you know, when offenders are due to be released, the more warning that they have, the better prepared that they can be. Our experience, again, speaking to victims, is that they often feel throughout the whole criminal justice process is they have no agency. Decisions are made on their behalf. Actions are taken that they often feel, that their rights and interests aren't really at the heart of all of that. And I think when it comes to, prisoners being released, I think it's all the more important that the people who've been affected by their offending in the first place are placed front and centre of being kept informed, of being kept up to date, of making sure that they have the support that they need. And I think, you know, when it comes to trauma-informed practice, it's a phrase that's bandied around quite freely. I think we would like to see it applied a little bit more, kind of specific to individual traumas. It's very much a kind of a catch-all phrase. And, you know, trauma takes many different forms. I think anyone who has experienced trauma experiences it uniquely, and the consequences that it has for them are also unique. So, again, the idea that a one-size-fits-all approach isn't always appropriate.
Just come back in on the basis, obviously, of, release planning and through care, with, you know, the view that there's going to be third sector approach, there'll be purposeful activity, there'll be, you know, activities in order to get them to reintegrate into the community. But the other thing as well is our whole justice system is around the actual punishment and rehabilitation aspect of that. You talk about safeguarding, you talk about early, you know, informing. But how, you know, having worked with the victims as well at the moment in terms of rehabilitation, is there any assurances or reassurances that when they do start to, you know, release plan or they are coming out of prison, that there is a proper rehabilitation programme in place, that there's not reoffending again?
Yeah, I mean, if I can just take that first of all, maybe. Victims that we work with will say that they want, you know, what are they looking for? They're looking for a justice system that's robust, that's going to keep them safe, and it's also going to ensure that what's happened to them doesn't happen to anyone else. And that is not the experience at the moment. You know, I've talked about the convictions whilst on bail, so that tells you that there's a problem. And getting this balance between justice and also rehabilitation, and so that appropriate programmes are put in place to ensure that people don't reoffend, along with the other for some of the other more root causes and fundamental services that may need to be in place. And I think the fact is that when you look at the remand population, for victims to have confidence in alternatives to remand, you are looking at scaling up a significant amount of resource, capacity, expertise, and frankly services for people with complex needs that I don't think in this country we've currently got at the scale that we would need. At the moment, victims are expressing a deep concern about their own safety and others' safety without all of those things being put in place. So yeah, I agree, rehabilitation properly and properly resourced rehabilitation, whether in custody or in the community, is an absolutely crucial part of that. And some of that will be about addressing specific offending types of behaviour. For, you know, we've talked about this before in relation, for example, to stalking and that very obsessive type of behaviour. And you know, and I'm going to use an example, you know, unpaid work, for example, as a response to that without anything else is unlikely to make any impact for those individuals. So, yep.
Emma, do you want to come in on that?
I don't really have anything to add to that, thanks.
Okay, thanks, convener.
Okay, thanks very much. I wonder if I can maybe just come in, kind of following up on some of the questions that Colette Stevenson's been asking about. And it's in relation to communication in particular with victims. So you may be aware the committee had a private session with survivors. And one of the things that came through to me loud and clear was the rather sort of mixed picture that exists in terms of contact and communication between, in particular, the courts while a case is being processed and a victim in order that they're clear what is happening and can plan their life and their family's life around that. So I'm interested in what opportunity you might think the bill provides in terms of, you know, it's we're obviously focusing on bail, remand, through care, release, but within that, a really key part is communication with victims. So is there an opportunity for the bill to provide an opportunity to improve the way that lines of communication exist? And if so, how would you like those lines of communication to be improved? I'll come to you first, Kate.
So I've outlined some of that, I think, earlier on in terms of gathering information from victims to inform risk assessments, that kind of thing. There is reference around release, around the reasons for refusing bail. I think, as I say, my view is that we should be given reasons for granting bail as well. I think that would be really helpful. Communication around release, some of which is picked up in here, but as I say, I think there's some more work needs to be done on that. But all of that, convener, I think, as I say, needs to be done within the... And it's just unfortunate, I guess, in terms of timing around the victim notification scheme review. If that had happened earlier, we could have been having this conversation around the recommendations from the victim notification scheme review, because I think a lot of what you're describing falls into that category too. But yeah, I think there is some attempt being made in here, and I can recognise that. It's about how it's actually going to work in practice. And we were very grateful to the committee for actually taking the time to discuss with victims directly, and I know they were too. They've expressed that to me, so thank you for that. But yeah, information around bail conditions, when those bail conditions change, breaches of bail, those kind of things are not routinely shared with victims at the moment. Anything that can be done to strengthen that would be enormously helpful, I think, because what you've got is people who are completely unaware sometimes of the risk that is around them, and where you will have heard those examples of you know, bumping into people in the supermarket or somebody appearing outside your house when you weren't expecting it because you didn't know that things had changed, and even where you had been in some cases told that you know, pretty much told that bail was going to happen and then it doesn't for whatever reason, not being aware of that and not being able to take steps around your own safety accordingly and your family's safety. So yeah, strengthening those types of communications, I think, and information would be helpful.
Can I just ask a quick follow-up to that, Kate, and then I'll bring in Emma. again, going back to the sessions that we had, I wasn't surprised, but one of the people that we spoke to spoke about how she received a lot of information from the police. In your view, who should have responsibility to communicate with a victim, particularly around, say, for example, the outcome of a bail appeal or a bail review and some of the other decision-making that takes place? Who do you feel is best positioned to have responsibility for that role? Or does it, I suppose, stretch across different organisations? For example, say, victim support, court system.
I mean, I think the complexity at the moment is the different types of bail as well. I think that doesn't help. I think what we would say is that information... So if someone's already been supported by a victim support organisation, then that working with that organisation can be enormously helpful. One of the challenges that people have expressed to us is information being shared with them. I mean, first of all, there's a problem of information not being shared with them at all. The other problem is when information is shared, being shared in a way that's anxiety provoking, that's not helpful for them to understand. You'll have heard some of those examples yourself. So these, the very cold clinical letters that come in, we're still getting examples of those letters coming in on a Friday afternoon, nobody around to be able to phone to ask for help. So we would advocate, I mean, from a trauma-informed perspective, I don't think there's one single answer to that apart from a clarity around roles and responsibilities, asking victims for their preference, where you can do that. And for some people, it might be that they don't want to be contacted directly themselves, but they would prefer a victim support organisation to be contacted first, who can then share that information with them in a way that may well be face-to-face and may not be a letter at all. It may be that because of the other challenge with letters, for example, is that you don't know what's in it until you've opened it. And I gave the example before, you don't expect people to open a letter giving them a cancer diagnosis without putting in a whole raft of support. Now, for some people, because of the trauma that they've experienced, that Emma's explained, the impact of opening a letter telling them that somebody's potentially already out, which is what can happen, can be pretty catastrophic. So making sure that there's choice, control, people have got, can choose around that and can pick what the best options are for them, I think would be, I'd love to give you an easier answer to that and a more simple answer to that question, but I don't think in a trauma-informed justice system, I don't think there is. I think the important thing is about making sure that information is shared and it's shared in a trauma-sensitive manner.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's helpful. Different modes of communication is something that I certainly haven't thought about, but I absolutely understand the value of that. So thanks, Kate. Emma, do you want to come in on any of that?
Yeah, I mean, I think when it comes to communicating with victims and witnesses in terms of court outcomes and bail hearings, sort of anecdotally, we hear from victims that this can be done in lots of different ways. It can come from different sources. It can quite often come from victim support. It'll come directly from the police. Sometimes the information isn't imparted until after the fact, as kind of referred to, which immediately puts the victim in a state of fear and alarm, because the person that has presented a risk to them previously is unexpectedly free, and they have to accommodate that. I think that the way in which information is passed on and who it comes from can make a huge difference. So if you have a nominated support worker who's happy to receive that information and take the time to sit down with you and talk, explain to you what it means, that's really helpful. Quite often when information is passed on to victims, it's not explained. So when it comes with legal terms or, sort of being told that bail conditions have been applied, but not explaining really what those bail conditions mean or how they work. I think all of these things, when they're done right, and there are lots of examples of good practice out there, when they're done right, they can have a hugely positive effect on victims. When they're not done right, when they're not done in a timely fashion, when, key information isn't explained or imparted or done so, through a letter, in an unexpected letter in the post, it can be really, really damaging. And we recognise that it's, there isn't an easy answer to that. It's not, again, it's not a sort of one size fits all, scenario, but it certainly does need to be considered. And we would like to see a higher priority placed upon how and when victims are informed and adequate explanations being given for the information that's being passed on as well.
Can I possibly come back in just to talk about the actual impact of that? I've spoken to this committee before about safeguarding and around suicide for victims and their families, and this is a really important implication of not communicating effectively. So, I'm sitting here with a briefing that's given me a number of examples of where victim support has had to phone emergency services to attend because we've received a phone call from someone who's been so traumatised about a letter coming through the post that they've then opened, not knowing what it was before they've opened it, that they've attempted to take their own life. Now, we've seen that an increase in those types of safeguarding concerns right from the beginning of the pandemic, but it actually hasn't really gone back to the levels that we would have normally had pre-pandemic, which is a big concern. But that's the real life impact of not taking a trauma-informed approach around communication and not taking care around it. In this briefing that I've got here, cold clinical letters that organisations think are doing what they should do because they're factual and they're factually accurate are having a massive impact on people's mental health to that degree. So I just thought it was important to bring that back in, given that we've got those examples.
No, that's helpful and appreciated. Okay, any other members have any? Jamie.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning. And thank you for your written submissions. I'd like to focus on the bill itself. I appreciate there are many more wider issues that we could be addressing as a committee, but for all intents and purposes, the limited time that we have, I'm keen to extract as much from you about the bill and its content. I'm focusing, first of all, on part one of the bill, which obviously is around the narrowing or restricting the parameters around which bail can be granted. Now, I presume the government would argue that our remand population is too high. Others may attest to that and agree with that point. And they would argue that the bill as currently drafted would, in all intents and purposes, meet its obligation to reduce remand population. In fact, the financial memorandum of the bill itself estimates that it would lead to around a 20% reduction in the remand population, which on current figures equates to around 1,800 people extra or additionally being released who otherwise would be remanded in the current system or status quo. So on the face of it, the bill meets its objectives. Would you, first of all, agree or disagree that the remand population is too high as a matter of principle, philosophically? And secondly, would you agree or disagree that the bill meets that objective of reducing the remand population, but does it do it in a way, as currently drafted, bearing in mind, that also meets the needs of victims? And I'll maybe start with Kate.
So in terms of the remand population, I think one of the key things that we need to remember is looking at what is driving. So the remand population has increased, that's true, but the profile of people who are in prison has changed over time in Scotland. I get a wee bit frustrated because people forget about presumption against short sentences in Scotland. So what presumption against short sentences, as you know, has meant that people who would have otherwise been in prison for sentences of less than 12 months are on the whole not there in as many numbers as they would have been before. So that changes who's in prison. The overall prison population numbers are down considerably to what they have been in the past. And when you look at what's driving the remand increase, of course, the proportion of people on remand was going to go up because of the presumption against short sentences category being removed. But when you look at the actual numbers, the increase in the remand population is being driven by people who've been accused of sexual offences, which increased over 20% to the year 21-22, and people who've been accused of violent offences, which went up by nearly 10%. It's not, as I said at the beginning, it's not even across all the different crime types. So when you consider that around 60% of people who are on remand, in the most recent figures anyway, are there for either sexual offences that they've been accused of or violent offences, then I think that paints a different complexion on who's actually in prison on remand. So that's something I think to consider. And as I said at the beginning, what we are saying is that remand has a purpose. And as long as we're really clear about that purpose in terms of public and victim and complainer safety, then remand will continues to have a place. Bail, and in terms of the use of bail, we've talked about this earlier on this morning around about making sure that people are protected and that there's robust risk assessments done when considering the use of bail. But there are considerable numbers of offences that people have been convicted for whilst they've been on bail for other offences. So that is something that has to be borne in mind as well. And as I said, you know, in 2019-20, there were 11 people convicted of murder or culpable homicide whilst they were on bail. There was over 70 people convicted of either rape, sexual assault or other sexual offences whilst they were out on bail. And there was 189 people convicted of either attempting murder or serious assault while they were out on bail. So that's the kind of context, I think, in which we need to consider around remand. And, you know, as I said earlier on, if the public and victims are to have confidence in reducing that remand population, then the alternatives have to be based on robust risk assessment and have to be in place with, you know, the adequate services for people with really complex needs, management, supervision and assurances that those services will be in place to keep people safe if we're going to use alternatives to remand.
I mean, just before I bring Kate in, sorry, just reading between the lines, you're saying that it's not simply the case that too many people are just being chucked in prison on remand. It's actually the profile of those who are being remanded has changed drastically, in part due to the presumption against short sentence, but also the nature of the crimes and certain types of crimes increasing. Therefore, those people really should be on remand, and those are decisions that are best made by judges under the current system. Of course, part one of the bill goes to great length to narrow the parameters in which judges can make those decisions. So I may ask you both about your concerns about that. But equally, looking at part one of the bill, it really, as far as I can see, doesn't do the second part of what you're asking for, which is saying that if you do let more people out, then you must also encounter strengthened bail conditions and the enforcement of bail conditions and the communication with victims around that, because this element of public safety is such a wide scope, it doesn't necessarily take into account some of the secondary types of crime and abusive behaviour that may result from someone being bailed. I personally can't see anything in the bill that addresses any of that or strengthens any victims' rights. So I wondered if you had spotted any, and for our intents and purposes, we have to amend this bill where possible, what should be going into it. So I'll throw that out there, because I'll bring Emma in and then feel free to come back to you, Kate.
Yeah, so I think in terms of the use of remand, I think that, you know, the public perception would very much be that in the interest of public safety, that where someone's guilty of committing an offence, you know, the idea that they are removed from society keeps everybody safe. In reality, obviously, that's, you know, that it's not practicable to lock up everybody who's committed offence, and neither should we. But I think when, you know, the reference to the prison population, where it's, you know, you have a real prevalence of offenders who have committed sexual and violent offences, you know, arguably they are the most serious offences, that victims experience or that the public would have concerns about, and quite rightly so. They should make up the majority of the prison population. We have concerns again around that narrowing, the limiting the restrictions. I think we certainly have concerns about repealing Section 23C, because it was specifically intended to address violence against women and girls. We would very much like to see something replace that. And more generally, I think, a greater, in terms of what changes could be made to the bill, I think we would like to see something a little bit more explicit in terms of what rights are afforded to victims, what victims can expect in terms of information being passed on, in terms of support offered, when they've been a victim of really serious crimes. I think that would definitely be a benefit, I think, to most of the people that we represent.
Do you think there's maybe a view that this is, that the judiciary is already currently quite well placed to make these sorts of decisions based on information that's available to them, and why on earth are politicians tinkering with that independence?
I think that yes, to a degree, the judiciary are absolutely well placed to be making decisions about these things. But I think what we would argue is that, that element of discretion is really important. I think if you start narrowing, if you make those restrictions, even more limiting, I think you made reference to in the in your written submission, that does increase the risk, to victims kind of more broadly. And that's something, we feel should be avoided at all costs.
I'll come back to you, Kate. So
that's quite a lot there. I suppose I'd flip it round that, we have no issue with, and the victims that we support have no issue with, remand being used for individuals who need it in order to keep victims or the wider public safe and secure, and having that as a key focus. What we do think is that victims' voices should be heard by criminal justice social work in a way that they're not currently, and decision makers prior to any decision being made on remand or bail. And we think that victims and complainers should be consulted on any bail conditions, as it will have a direct impact on them. And perhaps a more answer to your question, victims and the wider public safety, we believe, should be the primary consideration when making remand or bail conditions, which is not just quite exactly how the bill is worded at the moment. And also, in answer to your earlier question, robust action being taken to protect victims of crime when bail conditions are breached, and crucially, that information making its way back to sheriffs and judges in a way that it's not happening currently, which is impacting on the decisions that they're able to make. And we're very well aware that we're discussing remand and bail here, so this is, what we're talking about is people who have been accused of crimes, as opposed to those who've been convicted of them. So the removal of people's liberty at that stage is not to be taken lightly. You can still in Scotland be bailed for any, being accused of any crime, including murder. So that's worth bearing in mind. Another thing I wanted to say was just that victims of crime, it's really important that and complainers are kept up to date with any changes in terms of conditions that have been attached to bail, and also that they can request changes to conditions. So sometimes default conditions are put on that are completely inappropriate in individual circumstances. And at the moment, the justice system in Scotland doesn't afford victims the ability in the same way that it does to accused persons to be able to influence bail conditions. So that's something that could be addressed, Jamie, I think, in terms of the questions that you're asking. And then the last point is just what we've been discussing around making sure that information is passed to the right people and that there's clear protocols in place for that, particularly for victim support organisations, where, as I say, at the moment, information sharing between statutory organisations and some of the criminal justice agencies and institutions to third sector organisations is not done well at all.
And that's fascinating. I appreciate time is very tight, convener, but there's so much to cover, and I haven't even started on part two of the bill, but... I know, but thank you for your time. So, I mean, the problem is at the moment, Section 1 really only suggests that input from justice social work will inform decisions around bail, and we haven't even delved into the implications around resource and time and what effect that will have on. But there's nothing in there really that I can see that says that victims have to be consulted or that their voice or views will be heard. I wonder if the panel's aware of Kaye's Law, which has been introduced in other jurisdictions, which actually flicks the emphasis onto consultation with the victims of the crime of which the person's accused as a primary factor in consideration of whether bail is granted, and then the circumstances and needs of the perpetrator are taken into account. Is that a better balance, do you think?
I think that victims should be consulted, and information, as I laid out in what I said earlier, that information should be sought from them, yes. And as I say, if bail conditions are breached, then information shared back with them too, yeah.
I mean, I think what we would say is that, again, we hear time and again from victims that when it comes to the criminal justice process, in terms of making statements, giving evidence, you know, providing information that is necessary in order for a prosecution to go ahead, victims feel that they are you know, an active part of that, and their experiences are being taken into account. Once that side of things has been dealt with, though, they will more often than not feel completely surplus to requirements. And that's, you know, a lot of that is around information not being passed on, you know, in a timely fashion. That does happen time and time again. But more generally, it's about the fact that, you know, the purpose of a victim in a criminal justice process is to, you know, provide the relevant information in order for, you know, charges to be made or a prosecution to go ahead. But they're kind of wider well-being and their importance to the process isn't considered, and you know, we would certainly argue that they should be a more you know, they should be held at the heart of the process, really. You know, they are the reason that criminal justice procedures go ahead, because they have given of themselves in terms of making statements, talking about the things that have happened to them, and they do that in many senses. You know, that victims often will report offences not just because something has happened to them, but because they recognise that by reporting an offender, they're effectively protecting other members of the public. And then to be treated as if their experiences are no longer important because they've given a statement, or that their concerns aren't addressed, or that their safety isn't considered. You know, these are really, really damaging. And I think, you know, to make that point that the experiences and the voices of victims really ought to be at the heart of decisions, certainly around bail and remand anyway.
Thank you. That's a very nice summary. And I have to say that the evidence that we've taken from survivors is quite horrific in the way that the perpetrators are flaunting the system and abusing the system, even whilst on bail, to further traumatise their victims. And that's certainly not been dealt with. Convener, just with the benefit of time, rather than ask lots of questions on part two, would it be more suitable to perhaps write to the witnesses? Because I feel like we're listing a lot more in this session than we would get perhaps in written submissions. So
yep,
would that be suitable?
Content with that, yeah.
Thank you. OK, I'll leave it there then.
OK, thank you very much. OK, that's just the back of 11 o'clock, so I think we'll just draw the session to a close. And thank you very much, Kate and Emma, for your contribution this morning. And we'll just have a very short suspension to allow our witnesses to leave. Thank you very much. Thank you, members. Our next panel today consists of Dr. Hannah Graham, Senior Lecturer in Criminology in the Faculty of Social Sciences at the University of Stirling, Professor Fergus McNeill, Professor of Criminology and Social Work at the University of Glasgow, and joining us online is Professor Leslie McCara, Chair of Penology at the University of Edinburgh. So a warm welcome to you all. And I'm just going to move straight on to questions, if I may. We'll have around about an hour or so. So I wonder if I can just open up with a sort of general question and refer to the joint submission that yourselves, Hannah and Fergus, submitted to the committee, and kick off with a couple of questions around your comments on the grounds for refusing bail. In your submission, you say that the proposed two-part test for grounds for refusing bail, centering on public safety and risk of harm, is reasonable, and it is constructive that safety considerations of complainers are acknowledged within this. Now, obviously, we've just heard evidence from Victim Support Scotland, and they were keen to put victims' voices at the heart of the process of considering bail. So given, in the context of the comments that you've made, I'm just wondering what further comments you have, given what we've heard this morning. So maybe start off with you, Hannah, and then come to Fergus, and then I'll bring in Leslie. So, Hannah.
Thank you, convener, and thank you for having us. I guess we would contextualise our written evidence by saying that we've said that it's a step in the right direction and express the belief that a test of public safety can be developed that understands public safety and risk of harm, including the safety and risk to complainers. But also in the first paragraphs of our submission, we've also said that suggesting that the bill as put to the Parliament is sensible and constructive in the right direction of travel certainly does not negate perhaps the need for more focused scrutiny, the detail being thrashed out, amendments being proposed. And I think the public safety test, based particularly on what we have already heard from multiple panels of witnesses last year and this morning, there are some very sensible points being made by people to say we need to have a better understanding. The written submissions of the judiciary also point out that there might need to be more clarity. Otherwise, the point has been made that there could be appeals if there was a lack of clarity, or there could potentially be decision-making in a direction that is, I could say risk-averse, but I say that with an empathy for that, in a way to say if you're not sure what could be going too far because it's not clear, you might then decide in the way, and it might have a potentially counterproductive outcome to the policy intent of the bill and actually not necessarily result in reductions in remand and might increase bail refusal. So clarity is precious, and my own personal view, Fergus can add to it, is that more detail is needed. It would be helpful for those. It's a legal question around the public safety test, but it has very real consequences for people with lived experience, for the accused, for victims and for the wider community in Scotland. So more detail would be helpful on the parameters, because it is a potentially restrictive aspect of the bill. So for it to achieve its policy intent, you need to be clear for the courts to interpret that.
Yeah, I'll try to be brief. I mean, I would say, listening very carefully to the last session, there's a lot in that evidence which is obviously compelling. And for me, I find myself most strongly in sympathy with the comments made about information and communication. Those, to me, strike at the heart of the question of victims' interests in and need for procedural justice that takes them seriously, that attends to their interests and concerns, and that doesn't just use them as sources of evidence for the purpose of securing criminal convictions. So I think on all of those considerations, I was very much, I would align myself very much with what was said. But I think that there are two caveats I would add, just as reflections on the previous session, and actually more broadly, having looked at the deliberations of the committee today and read the record and also read some of the submissions. First of all, unintentionally, I think, there's a false dichotomy created when we start talking about victims and offenders as if they're two separate groups of people. I'm sure Leslie could speak to this from her research better than I can. But if you look at the prison population compared with the general population, you'll find disproportionately high rates of victimisation, trauma and violence inside prison rather than outside. So we should be really careful here when we're talking about the interests of victims that we need to think about that in a broader sense. So I want to resist the false dichotomy. And with respect to bail decisions and remand, it's important to remember that we're talking largely about accused persons, not offenders, strictly speaking, when we're considering remand. It's also worth remembering that prison imprisonment, whether for remand or particularly in relation to short sentences, is not a magic box that removes or eliminates risk and keeps us safe. It's actually more likely to serve as an incubator of risks. And therefore it stores up problems of harm that might come later. So to get to the point about the test, the public safety test, I think what the legislation is trying to do, if I'm reading it correctly or reading the intention behind it, is draw a distinction between a current system which asks judges to think about the risk of reoffending, which is a judgment of likelihood, but doesn't really take into account or consider gravity, and a system which is more preoccupied with gravity, with seriousness. And actually much of the evidence discussed in the last session was about serious harm in relation to gender-based violence, sexual offending, and so on. And the legislation isn't aiming to reduce the use of remand in cases where those kinds of risks exist. So I think it's important to try and be clear about the shift from likelihood to gravity, and maybe this is something that the committee could ask the Cabinet Secretary or senior civil servants later, but that's my understanding of what the effect of the legislation would be. It shifts the judgment from mere likelihood of an offence to consideration of the likely gravity of the offence and its of an offence, a re-offence and its potential impact. I'll stop there, sorry.
Okay, thanks very much indeed. I'll just come straight to you, Leslie, to pick up on that and maybe also pick up on the points that Fergus made earlier. So over to you.
Okay, thanks. So I would say I very much welcome the intent of this bill, and listening to Kate Wallace in particular, who was talking about the need for robust decision making, making that will enable safety and that will actually not harm others, and will, for me, I think that the intent behind the bill is a good one. I think the notion of having very strong information, robust risk assessments in bail decisions is a very welcome one. So I welcome those aspects of this bill. Devil, of course, is in the detail in terms of how it will be interpreted, how public safety will be interpreted. But I do agree with Fergus that the intent to shift more towards looking at the gravity and the potential risk in a more robust way in bail or remand decisions is something that actually will, in a sense, forward the wishes and intentions of our previous witnesses to this committee. The devil is in the detail in terms of how it will work in practice and whether social work, justice social work, will have the time and resource needed in order to be able to furnish those robust risk assessments and provide robust supervision and electronic monitoring being appropriately resourced as well. That's actually where, for me, the big question marks reside. This is not a question of there'll be fewer remands, but there will be a need for more resource. Mm-hmm.
Thanks for that. So just following on from those responses. In terms of, obviously, a key part of the decision-making process is the information that is provided to the court on which decisions are based. And obviously, the provisions in the bill puts criminal justice social work kind of front and centre of that. And in your very detailed submission, you articulate your views on other contributions, both to the bail decision-making process, but elsewhere in, for example, release from custody, so third sector, for example. So can you perhaps, and I'll come back to you, Leslie, on this, and then bring in Hannah and Fergus, maybe just outline a little bit about your thoughts on the proposals specific to criminal justice social work and what your kind of feeling is on the practicalities of that, for example, resourcing, which is something that we're hearing time and time again.
Well, actually, if you're going to put this into practice in terms of a bail decision, the timing is actually quite tight sometimes for that. And so some of the kinds of risk assessments that need to be done actually take a bit of time. And so there needs to be an immediate capacity to respond at that point. So that's something that's really important. One of the things that you see from a previous research when you looked at why reasons for the judiciary not choosing social work supervision, supervised bail is because there's a belief that there is a scarcity of resource there, even sometimes where that resource actually exists. So there needs to make sure that there is an immediate capacity to respond. Mm-hmm. That then needs, in terms of the supervision, there needs to then be access to be able to mobilise services and support quite rapidly as well, certainly for certain offenders who have, or people who are accused, who have quite complex needs. So there needs to be a capacity to mobilise resources very quickly. And then in terms of electronic monitoring, which I think is actually a very welcome aspect of this bill, to make sure that that can be put in place, and again, monitored carefully as well. So I think that it's, we know that social work can do extremely robust risk assessments. The Care Inspectorate has always been very praising of their risk assessment capacity. But it's being able to do this, having the time to do it, having the time to do the supervision, having the time and the resources to mobilise very quickly. And those are things that need to be put in place. What we know from earlier research on bail supervision is actually, although that is resource intensive, it's actually cheaper in a sense than sending people to on remand. So it actually is a cost effective way of doing it, but it does need resource, and some of that is time, and that is a capacity to mobilise very quickly. So it, in that sense, it is the intention is a really good one. It's whether there is a resource in place to enable that to happen. And social workers would be very competent, obviously, to do all this supervision. There's no question about that.
Yep. Thank you, Leslie. Hannah, and then Fergus.
Yes, so I would agree with that. And in our evidence submission, we draw attention. It is the career calling of criminologists to draw attention to potential for unintended consequences or potential for collateral consequences. So the time pressures at the point of bail and remand decision-making are acute. Then you have time pressures for justice social workers, workload and workforce considerations. And I would emphasise the evidence that's already been heard from Social Work Scotland and their reports on workforce turnover of social workers and workforce pressures, and also evidence by Alison Babbage to the Health and Social Care Committee about it needing to be a sustainable profession that does not burn out. And so if we give the example of the implementation, which is in the early stages of electronically monitored bail, which was a component authorised by the Management of Offenders Act in 2019. It's available across a set amount of local authorities, but not all of them yet. There could be differences in forms and procedures in each one of those different local authorities, and that's not even to go with courts and court areas, which might overlap different local authorities. And then quick decision-making and needing to balance that with good decision-making. So I would very much so underscore the professionalism and the skill set of justice social workers, but be attentive to their fairly earnest concerns about their availability, whether they have access to the court, and to also suggest that there is interim findings. We said this in our submission from a small Scottish study of decision-making on bail and remand, where the judiciary who have participated in that and the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal practitioners who have participated in that have said there are resource implications, there are questions around time and availability. We've drawn attention to the amount of remand that's used for between 1 and 7 days. It's not always an either-or, and if that happens to you, that affects your children, partner, work responsibilities. But also there is the gravity of weighing up, is the judiciary would not take that decision lightly, and is 1 or 4 or 5 days to get the information and the assessment needed appropriate, weighed against the prospect of a lengthy wait on remand if remand is indeed opposed. So I'm not unsympathetic or unaware of the pressures that are there. The other thing that I would briefly draw attention to is that I'll declare an interest. I'm a member of the Scottish Sentencing Council, but I'm not speaking on behalf of the council. We did a piece of work, a consultation with the judiciary on judicial perspectives of community-based disposals. Obviously, because of our remit, that would relate more to sentencing than to the bail and remand stage of proceedings. But there is some relevances in judicial perspectives on availability and in the Kate Skellington Orr research and in the Sentencing Council research, the judiciary being open to informed views on risk assessment, professionals who are qualified to assess and give a view of vulnerability, of need, and on the continuity and availability consistently across Scotland. So the judiciary do have views on that at the point of bail and remand decision-making, and they're echoed in wider work that's been done on how do we support community-based supports and measures, but also decision-making on what's available if you're going to move away from bail refusal in some cases and remanding people. So there's quite a few factors in there, but I would certainly commend the place of justice social work and the importance of their contributions to the court.
Thank you. Fergus.
Again, I'll try and be very brief. It's a quarter century since I was a justice social worker, I've just calculated. And if I were a justice social worker asked to advise a court on a bail decision under this legislation, what I would want is clarity about what the public safety test means so that I can give information and advice that is appropriate. So I think that's important. In doing that, I can imagine a process where there might be two stages. So you could, I don't want to overstep here, I'm not a practitioner and I haven't been for a long time, so my kind of capacity to make constructive suggestions about the detail of practice is limited. But it seems to me that you could triage and then you could select the cases that need closer examination under the public safety test. So if somebody's coming to court, bail is being opposed, but there's no indication from the index offence or from the previous record that there are violent offences or sexual offences or the kinds of pattern of behaviour that give rise to public safety concerns, then a triage might be enough to say it looks as if, on the face of it, the public safety test here suggests that bail might be possible. What would we need then to provide in terms of bail supervision and support in order to safely and effectively manage this person in the community? And how might that contribute to risk reduction? Because if we put them in jail to await a sentence, then there's a risk that they'll lose accommodation, that they'll lose contact with substance use services, that they'll have family disruption, etc., making it worse, incubating risk. So I can well imagine justice social workers doing an excellent job at that stage of making or putting together constructive advice for judges to make appropriate decisions in those cases, but it would require resourcing. And specifically, I think it would require resourcing in court social work units. Just to make a connection again to the previous session, court social work units also have responsibilities towards victims and witnesses, and they are, by virtue of their position in the court, better able than community-based social workers to undertake that communication in the flow of the business of the court. So I can imagine ways in which significant additional investment in court-based social work might address a range of concerns here simultaneously.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Okay, I'm going to open it up, and I think Fergus Fulton, you want to come in and get my Fergus's and Fulton's muddled up, and then Jamie. Or Jamie, do you want to ask a very quick follow-up, and then I'll bring in Fulton?
Yeah, I'll keep my substantive questions to later, but I just wanted to... Good morning, sorry. It is morning. I'm really intrigued by something you said there, and I just wanted to maybe pick your brains on something. There's a wide expectation that if bail is unopposed, then bail is granted. And if bail is opposed and that opposition is sought for, then the judge clearly has a process and protocol to follow. Is it your understanding or your belief that opposition to bail has been overused? And by that, I mean, you know, clearly it's been opposed for good reason, based on the information available to the Crown and the prosecution. So why are we seeking to resolve the problem by limiting the discretion of the judges in the scenario where bail is opposed, rather than educating the Crown on the parameters that they would use to oppose bail? Because there are two sides to the coin, and which is the best way to address it?
I wish I could give you a good answer to the question, but I honestly don't know. And I'm not sure. I mean, Hannah may know, or Leslie may know better than me, but I think the decision-making of prosecutors in relation to case marking in general in Scotland is not the best understood or the most researched of topics. And I'm not even sure what the reasons are why that's been neglected, but I can't think of any significant studies in that area for some time that would help us understand whether there is, for example, precautionary or defensive decision-making about opposing bail, which might indicate a problem that needs to be addressed through education of procurators fiscal, or I just don't know. I can't answer that.
Do you see my point, though, is that the bill seeks to address the problem through the other end of the problem by the parameters in which the judge can make the decision on whether bail is granted. But if the primary source of the amount of people going through the bail decision rests initially with the Crown and their opposition to bail or not, as the case may be, then is that maybe a better way to see if there's a problem there first before you then restrict the discretion of the judges?
I would see that as an either or, and I think that we have enough evidence that maybe this is something you might want to ask about, but I think we have enough evidence that we are using remand in ways which are out of line with norms in other Western European countries. I think that there's sufficient evidence to suggest that we do need to think about structuring judicial discretion, and that's what legislation in relation to criminal procedure and sentencing does. So I don't think there's anything inherently controversial about doing that, and I think it might be a case of both and rather than either or in relation to your question.
I'll maybe come back to that later. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Fulton, then Colette, Russell and Rona. So Fulton, then Colette.
Thanks, Convener. I want to ask about resources that we've been talking about there. And at this stage, I'll draw members and the panel's attention to my register of interest as well. As a previous criminal justice social worker, as well as Fergus. I think it's, for me, this is the sort of the crux of the question. And having previously worked in that area, as Fergus, as you referred to, there's community justice teams, and there's occasionally, I think it was Leslie that said that there's sometimes bail supervision teams for certain local authorities in different kind of forums, but every team's got a community justice team. So I'm not really clear, and there probably wouldn't be anything in the legislation, it would be for local authorities to decide, but I'm not really clear who would take on this work. Would it be bail supervision teams? Would they be enhanced, which I think would be a personal preference, or would it be the community justice teams pick it up and almost do a sort of mirror of what they're doing with people who are convicted on community payback orders, etc., etc.? And I did ask social work about this when they were in, and I think they said, well, we'll just need to see where it goes and what sort of funding would be available. I'm just wondering, from the panel's point of view, how do you see it working in that respect, and what sort of additional resources are we talking about here? Is that something that, from an academic point of view, you've thought about? I'm okay with any order.
I'll answer very briefly and say I can't answer on the question of resources. I haven't studied that sufficiently to offer any informed guesswork even. And I think the answer to the other part of your question is that there are 32 ways of doing justice social work in Scotland. And I don't think that the Scottish Government could or would seek to impose a mechanism for the implementation of the responsibility that it would create. And I'm sure they would justify that on the grounds that they would need to allow each local authority to make arrangements that were commensurate with the needs of its area, which is different. You know, the situation in Highland is different from the situation in Glasgow. So I think there's something reasonable about that. However, I think it's always a dilemma with justice social work that justice, by its nature, needs to be delivered in a way which is consistent nationally. For reasons of fairness. So it would not be, to my mind, appropriate not to have bail support and supervision available nationally if we implement legislation that seeks to alter the use of remand in Scotland. So I think there's a delicate tension between local responsiveness and national consistency in this area, which I'm sure the committee's well-versed in other areas.
Yeah, and just to emphasise again, the interim report of research that we do have, the participants who are judicial or procurators fiscal are emphasising they're concerned about resourcing and availability, mirrored in Scottish Sentencing Council issues paper with judicial perspectives, predominantly shareval perspectives around time, availability, workload. If you get notice of something, there's then marking. You might not get the information from police or the fiscals that you need, and you've got an hour or two to quickly do a turnaround with the greatest of professionalism. If there's multiple cases where this might need to be considered, how are you going to triage or emphasise that? Could I also, perhaps with the joy of academic freedom, we don't do research on costings. That is for the Scottish Government, the Scottish Parliament and the partners to perhaps do more on their budgets and spending. But could I acknowledge the considerable amount that goes on prisons and prison building? The electronic monitoring contract could be in the order of £44 million. The digitalisation of the LSCMI, so the level of service case management inventory, when there was an issue with that, which is ongoing, we can find £3 million quite quickly for an IT fix. So my championing would be echoing the concerns expressed by Community Justice Scotland and Social Work Scotland in submissions to the committee on other fronts, as well as by local authorities to say, we know that funds are tight and that there's no magic money tree, but please, community justice ends up being what our colleague Gwen Robinson calls the Cinderella of the justice system, expected to quietly do a lot of work with diminishing resources. And we would emphasise the importance of them being able to do their work well. People who are accused and people who are complainers would want professionals having the time to contribute towards an informed decision, and justice social workers are central and pivotal to that. They have the ability to communicate with empathy and to make those decisions, or not decisions, but to inform decisions about risk in a way that a letter can't. And so we're not in danger in Scotland of too much money being spent on justice social work or community justice relative to our other substantive commitments in clearing the court backlog, police, prisons. We're talking hundreds of millions of pounds there. So a plea to scrutinise what is available to justice social work would be my emphasis.
Yeah, Leslie?
Yes, thank you. Can I come in? So I just want to go back to the points also that Fergus is making there about the need for some degree of uniformity of service or consistency of service across Scotland, whilst not undermining the sort of local responsivity. But there does need to be that. And it seems to me that reflecting on what resources actually exist already, that you are going to need to have probably specialist bail supervisory teams and services, an additional set of services. This is not something that can just be added to justice social work responsibilities just now. You're going to need that in order to be able to have that kind of uniformative service and the capacity to respond in the kind of way that's going to be needed in this fast, responsive and mobilised way. One other aspect about the tightness of resources and how justice social work is, as Hannah was saying, it's not always the thing that has the most money spent on it. One of the things also that's important in terms of some of the services that might need to be accessed, there are also third sector services that might need to be accessed, both in terms of this part of the bill, but also to do with the through care provisions that are being proposed. And third sector agencies at the moment are also very precarious in terms of funding and support and resource and capacity to continue to provide some of the fantastic services that they do. So there is a big issue about how you sustain high quality services right across the piece in justice social work and the services that they need to actually mobilise. Things like mental health services and community mental health services, again, things that might need to be mobilised as part of this whole bill's offer that actually are deeply under-resourced. So there needs to be very careful planning here, and I think additional social work resources to support specialist bail supervisory teams if this is going to really work. And it's a really important thing that the bill is trying to do. Remember that almost more than half of people who are remanded in custody don't end up with a custodial sentence. That's a really important figure to remember. As much as we know that most of the people who are put on remand do not transition to a prison sentence.
And just make a plea for fairly short and succinct questions and answers, because members have got lots and lots of questions, and I'm just trying to balance constructive responses with nice, neat questions built in.
Thanks, Convener. And thanks for that, Leslie. I think you've actually articulated pretty well where my thoughts just now are on this. And I think that, you know, although social work weren't able to commit to that when they and the various organisations met with us recently, I think that it would make sense that it's a separate team, and therefore I think you are talking about significant resource implications there, and the committee will need to take that into account when speaking to the Cabinet Secretary, and I'd be happy to take that forward. In terms of what the convener said there about being briefed, my final question is on the same basis, but it might be something that you're not able to answer. There's also discussion that the investigations that committees have been having separately about possibility of criminal justice social work coming over to the National Care Service, which I can see by some nods that you're aware of. Do you think, what impact do you think that might have on the discussion that we've just had there? And based on what the convener said, as brief as possible. Thanks.
It's highly relevant. It's a fundamental structural proposal. And the thing that I would emphasise is that there won't be a status quo for justice, social work and community justice easily, whether it is included or whether it is excluded from the institution of the National Care Service. The same, things won't continue the same of if you just leave it out. They will continue to work with people who may still need access to various services and supports, and being outside of a rather large institution that is supposed to mirror the NHS could have an impact, just the same as being inside and thinking, how do public protection considerations fit in a National Care Service? So my submission to the Scottish Government on the National Care Service consultation was that not enough thought and planning and detail had gone into considerations of the inclusion or exclusion of justice social work. So we could offer a more informed view when there's any detail beyond a few paragraphs being provided to us. But I'd say that the consequences either way could be far-reaching.
I think that's fair and probably quite reflective of other evidence we've heard in this area, because the proposals are at a very early stage. I'm happy for the last answer, convener, or just to leave it at that, at your discretion.
Thank you very much. I'll bring in Colette and then Russell.
Yeah, thanks, convener, and good morning. I was going to say, I'm just checking the time there. It is still morning, yeah. It was just quickly a quick question based on what you'd mentioned about uniformity. I had previously attended the youth court within Hamilton Sheriff Court, and the actual Justice Social Work Department are actually based within Hamilton Sheriff Court, and I thought that was really relevant and based on what you're talking about within each of the local authorities. I'm just wondering what research has been carried out by yourselves in terms of comparisons of each local authorities to see what good practice and how that's actually working out. But I personally found that really, really helpful, that they were actually in-house within Hamilton Sheriff Court.
I can maybe answer briefly. I've looked at that question historically in Scotland, and I've also looked at it comparatively in relation to European countries and different ways of structuring and organising probation or justice social work services. And there's no straightforward answer to the best model, but I think that there is really instructive learning from different contexts and from our own history. In Scotland, in contrast with England, probation grew up in local services, so not court-linked services, but services that were embedded within localities. And there was a very lively debate as far back as the 1930s about whether or not they should move, like the English system, to a court-based model, the then English system, to a model where probation services were coterminous with court jurisdictions and closely linked to the role of being an officer of the court and serving the magistrates in England. And they argued vociferously against it in the Scottish context because of the importance of local connectivity, as they understood it, for rehabilitation, for reintegration. That debate comes and goes, and in different European jurisdictions of similar size to us, sometimes you have a national probation service, sometimes you have a single correctional service where prisons and probation functions are together, sometimes you have municipalities or local authorities heavily involved in the delivery and different sub-national variations. I think the only kind of lesson I can draw from it all is that you absolutely need very clear and well-established and well-functioning relationships with courts and parole agencies as well, and also with prisons. That you can't function effectively in doing probation work without those. But that if your end goal is the reintegration of people who've been through criminal justice systems so that they do not reoffend, then you also absolutely need really rigorous and effective integration with the work of local authorities or municipalities. So it's a both, again, a bit of a fudge, but it's a both and. And there's a third leg, which is the national, which is to say that it needs to be coherently linked to criminal justice and social policy at the national level. It's not just a criminal justice policy issue either, because reintegration depends on health, on housing, on education, and on all forms of social welfare. So whatever way you cut the cake, mixing my metaphors, whatever way you organise it, you need local, you need criminal justice connectivity, and you need national policy coherence and consistency. That doesn't really answer the National Care Service question either, but I was only going to say in response to that, I agree with Hannah. It's almost impossible to comment at the moment meaningfully because I don't understand what the proposal would entail.
Thanks. I don't know if Leslie wants to come in on that.
No, I agree with my colleagues on that.
Okay, thank you.
Take a brevity.
And Hannah, finally. No, okay, thank you. Thanks, convener.
I'll hand over to Russell and then I'll bring in Rona.
Thank you, and also good morning. My first question relates to bail. As we know, judges make the decision as to whether someone should or should not be remanded. Now, the judiciary have expressed some opposition to this bill. They seem downright hostile, but it's actually quite difficult for us to interpret this because they've declined our invitations to come here and give evidence and answer questions. And I think that's making our job a little bit more difficult than it should be. Now, Hannah, you're on the Scottish Sentencing Council. You're not a judge, but you're perhaps the closest we'll get to hearing from that sector. And I know you're not speaking for the Scottish Sentencing Council, you've already said that, but can either of you give me any sense, or any of you give me any sense as to what the opposition is to the bill? Is it perceived to be meddling in judicial independence? And also whether you've got a view as to whether you think they should come and give evidence to us?
The difference between myself and the judiciary could probably not be more pronounced if we tried, but I welcome trying to reflect on it. So it is their prerogative to take that view, and I would have been surprised if they did not oppose this. The judiciary are famous for their love of their independence, entire PhDs, including one by Fiona Jameson at the University of Edinburgh, have been written about how the judiciary feel about themselves as decision makers, and the Scottish judiciary in particular are infamous for wanting that discretionary decision making, but with regard to the law that they're enforcing. So they have raised a few concerns, and I found the concerns very interesting and apt, as you would expect from our distinguished colleagues, but not necessarily persuasive enough to say that there is no justification, in my own view, for the bill. But the questions, if I could refer to comments that have been made in a public conference at the Inspectorate of Prisons with the Cabinet Secretary for Justice, Joe Griffin and Theresa Medhurst, standing alongside Lady Dorrien, the Lord Justice Clerk, so in a public forum, around the bill, were that the judiciary had a real emphasis on trying to visit prisons and keep themselves acquainted with the realities of not only their decision-making but the consequences of their decision-making. And in her very articulate and formidable remarks, which were reflected in the written submission by the senators, some astute questions, and I have my handwritten notes from the day, what is meant by public safety? Precision and detail is important while still having due regard to judicial independence. And also questioning around what would happen in instances where there is the prospect or the potential for destruction of evidence that does not meet the public safety test. So what are the details and the further discussions and questions that you could be asking where there might be interference in the administration of justice or potential interference in the administration of justice? For example, maybe an instance where someone wants to destroy a device, where it might implicate themselves. So how do we have a responsiveness in some cases where there could be things that are relevant to the fair administration of justice but are not necessarily of the level that they would pose a risk to public safety and to complainer and victim safety as such?
Should they come and see us?
I would very much welcome that. Perhaps they could correspond with you. They're very skillful communicators. And I note that Lord Carloway emphasised in the beginning of his submission around consultation and engagement with the judiciary and how much the Scottish Government had or had not done that. And so I think they are key decision makers. They have a lot of experience and expertise. Their reasoning has been captured by modest research and in some data, but I would be supportive of their engagement with this because they can speak to things that we can only know or ask about.
Okay. Would either of you like to come on that?
Very briefly, again, I'll try to summarise. So I think what the bill, again, is trying to target is reducing the use of remand with people who do not pose a significant risk to public safety but are troublesome because of persistent offending. And I think that that is effectively the same population that previous legislation has tried to address through the presumption against short sentences. That legislation has been passed and implemented and the ceiling hasn't collapsed. Right? Crime rates have not shot through the roof. I'm pretty sure that sheriffs and judges would have had reservations about the presumption on the same sorts of grounds that you're raising in relation to the way in which this test is being conceived in respect of bail. I understand why they would be reluctant or why they would be critical of a move that might restrict their discretion. I think any professional would find it
finds it irksome to have their discretion constrained. But from my perspective, from a criminological perspective, and this is not to criticise individual judges or their individual decisions, if I look at the Scottish data, both in relation to the use of custody as a sentence and in relation to the use of remand, we're out of kilter with comparable nations, and something has to be done to change that. And I think part of that is best achieved through passing legislation which structures judicial discretion appropriately in pursuit of legitimate public policy objectives that relate to the proper use of public funds. Because prison is a very expensive resource that we should use as sparingly as possible, both pre-trial and once people are convicted. So I'd leave it at that, I think.
Thank you. Now, Dr. Graham, in the past... I didn't know if she wanted to.
Yeah, sorry, can I just add into this? I mean, I think it's really important to engage the judiciary about all of this, because actually efforts in the past, going back way back to 1992, when I also was working in the Scottish office at then, evaluating the implementation of national objectives and standards for social work justice services, which were aiming to reduce the use of custody by changing the behaviour of sentences by increasing their confidence in what was happening in the community. And that didn't work because they didn't get the confidence of the judiciary. So it's really important to engage them if this bill is actually going to have an impact. I do think, however, that the way in which it has been framed within the bill at the moment, rather than in some level, it is narrowing judicial discretion, but on another level, it gives them enormous scope for decision making around public safety, including the safety of the complainer, or preventing significant risk of prejudice to the interests of justice. That is there's a lot of interpretation that can go into that. In some level, they actually do have quite a lot of discretion. And I think some of the cases where the risk to the public, the concerns of the victims groups that we're talking this morning, that will already be covered by these provisions within the bill. So I do think you need to engage the judiciary. I do think there is something to be discussed about how one might interpret public safety. But I actually think there's quite a lot of discretion that will go with the way in which the bill is framed at the moment. So I don't think that they should be too precious about how much this is narrowing discretion, if I'm being frank.
Thank you. Thank you. Now, in the written submission from Dr. Graham and Professor McNeill, 12 pages long, and there's a lot of quite strong opinion in there, I think. And, you know, in the past, Dr. Graham, you've been politically critical of myself and my party, and we're thick-skinned and it's entirely your prerogative. But I do wonder if such political commentary risks undermining sort of academic neutrality. And also, I wonder how that reflects on our ability to assess this evidence that you've submitted. Is it personal opinion, or is it academic research, or something in between?
With any piece of research that I've been involved with in terms of community justice or prisons or courts or sentencing, the publications, I can assure that the rigour with which the methodology and the publishing of our studies and where we present evidence and findings, that is usually fairly transparently accounted for. If, for example, I've done research on electronic monitoring or have done research with the courts through the Aberdeen Community Justice Partnership and Sheriff Court and so on, research in Australia, the pieces of evidence where we do cite evidence and say in this study it was recommended that, I would hope that the committee could find that evidence to be of an academic standard, that it has been released and published, and I haven't had substantive queries about methodology or around concerns of the quality of the academic evidence. I'm a social scientist, and so I'm unapologetic about drawing attention to social structures, inequalities, the harms and the powers where institutions intend to do well but may have unintended consequences. Public academia or public criminology, of which Leslie and Fergus and others in our research centre are prone to, often asks for our opinion. And I guess things like opinion pieces, careful scrutiny, and I can suggest that I take, I read and listen to nearly every speech that quite a few members of different parties here produce, that it's important to understand that the politicisation of crime and justice can have an impact, and it is not necessarily something that I would shy away from commenting on, but nor is academic quality and neutrality drastically underlined by highlighting that punitiveness or that something that might be considered progressive can have certain impacts. So my career stands, and I'm proud of it.
Thank you. Have I got time for...
Can I maybe just...
Thanks, Convener. I'm not sure, although Dr. Graham probably was quite happy to answer the question, I'm not sure that my colleague Russell Finlay's question was appropriate. We get people in here who are councillors, maybe they're with Clausler or whatever, then they have actual party allegiances. And I'm just not sure. I've not formed my discourse on this here, but I'm not sure whether that was an appropriate line of questioning or build up to the question, convener, and therefore I'm seeking yours or the clerk's advice.
If I may, thank you for raising that. I'm happy with the question, and I was happy to give Dr. Graham a chance to respond. I'm very happy for the session to come back to the bill, and on that note, I don't intend to taking any more questions related to political views. So on that note, I'll hand over to Rona. Thank you.
Thanks, convener. I wanted to go back to something that Professor McNeill said at the start, and it's about gravity of risk. If I understood correctly, you're saying that you don't believe the bill's for serious or solemn offences per se. And if that's the case, and the fact that there's one public safety test for all offences, does that not send out the wrong message to victims, for example? And should the current exceptions not still stand in relation to domestic abuse and sexual offences? And could I maybe have your opinion on the specific nature of individual risk and public safety around the bill?
I'm not sure I understand, or I think you might have misunderstood what I meant. So let me try and explain.
Sure, yeah.
Let me try and explain what I mean. Whenever and the RMA can speak to this, obviously as the body with specific responsibility for developing standards and practice in relation to risk assessment and management in Scotland. But from an academic perspective, whenever you're engaged in risk assessment, you're considering two things. One is the likelihood of an adverse event. And the second is the degree of the adversity. And the two things are, it's easier to predict the probability part of that, the first part, than it is to predict the severity or the gravity part.
Yeah.
So when we're dealing with gender-based violence, sexual offending, violence in domestic context and in intimate relationships, the tools that are developed to assess risk in those cases are more sophisticated because they're not just trying to calculate the likelihood. So to roll back slightly, the LSCMI, which Hannah mentioned, is a generic tool which tells us only how likely it is that any further offence might happen. Mm-hmm. It doesn't tell us anything about severity or gravity if the offence happens. Okay. Other tools are then used in appropriate cases where we're concerned about violence of different sorts, to try to reach a more informed and actually, in a way, to go back to the point about judges, a structured discretionary judgment about what the risk is and what the gravity is. So all I'm saying is what the bill is asking or what the bill would require judges to do is to take into account not a mere calculation of the likelihood of any offence happening when a person's on bail, but rather whether such an offence would be so serious that it would pose a significant harm. Now, I'm using that language. That's not defined in the bill. Mm-hmm. But that's my point. I think that does need to be clarified, what the public safety test is. And I think it applies both at the level of the risk to individual complainers, which absolutely should be uppermost in the mind of sheriffs and judges when considering cases where there are crimes against individual persons, then, you know, clearly the bail decision must very seriously assess any risk to the safety of the complainer. But the wider question about risk to others is another question, and a complicated question. And I think that the bill is directing sheriffs and judges to pay more attention to that set of considerations, not merely the likelihood of any offence happening. So it's basically, to put it in really simple terms, the bill is saying, to my mind, and please do ask ministers and civil servants if I'm right about this later, it's saying persistent offending in and of itself might not be a reason to refuse bail. Serious offending probably is.
So, if in effect, you're saying, to take it at a very basic level, common sense should be used in domestic abuse cases, that it's... Brilliant. I mean, there has to be a pattern anyway before there would be a conviction. So, surely that does come down to common sense without you having to use specific parameters.
Yes, but I also agree with the previous panel that... In respect of any form of gender-based violence, including in domestic violence, I think clarity needs to be given here, either in the bill or in guidance related to the bill, so that both the social workers and others involved in informing judicial decision-making about bail decisions are clear about what it is that they're assessing, who they're speaking to, how they gather evidence to inform those judgments. That's critically important. And to me, if there's risk of violence, whether psychological, physical, or sexual, or coercive control, absolutely, then there's no question that we need the most rigorous risk assessment processes before making a decision about bail.
Thank you. That's really helpful. Can I ask Professor McCarra her opinion on that, if you have?
Yes. No. I mean, I completely agree with Fergus there. I don't think that the wording of the bill is going to mean that in very serious cases that real careful decision making will take place in terms of risk to the complainant and the risk to others, whether remand may be appropriate in certain very serious cases. So I agree with Fergus. I think that the waiting on the gravity here, I think, is actually really important. And I think that will be by doing that, actually the bill will both hopefully support victims of crime, but also equally help to reduce the remand population itself, so that certain people who are petty persistent offenders might not get caught up in the remand system, but may have supervision that diminishes their risk of continuing to offend on bail, but that actually the services and support in terms of what we can do in terms of remand within prison for people who have to be remanded, that actually that will work more effectively. And one of the issues about having so many people on remand is that the access to support people who have been put on remand is actually diminished. Mm-hmm. If you have a smaller and a more seriously offending population within that remand group, you will have actually more capacity to work with them as well. So there's a payoff in that respect as well. So I'm very convinced that the gravity is an important consideration here, and with appropriate and robust and good risk assessment and good input, good information given to the people who have to make the decisions, that's a critical thing, that actually the public safety would not necessarily be compromised by the bill.
Thank you. That's helpful too. Dr. Graham, would you like to? No, you're happy with that. Well, thank you. I think that's been really helpful, and I think it's good that you both agree. Maybe more clarity is needed on that point. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Yep. I'm going to bring in Katie and then Jamie, and then we'll run just as long as we need. But if questions and answers can be succinct, and Katie, over to you.
Yes, and I don't think it's clear whether the effect of this legislation is going to be to change the numbers of people on bail. It's not really clear how the public safety test is going to operate. Fergus, when you gave evidence, you said that bail is used in quite a different way in Scotland than in other European countries. And we know that Scotland has both the highest numbers of people in jail and also within that the highest numbers on remand, and it's approaching 30% now, which is extremely high. Could all of the witnesses, if they wish, maybe comment on what the arguments are for and against the approach that we take in Scotland, which is one where we send quite a lot of people on remand into the prison system, and whether there's lessons to be learnt from other jurisdictions, other comparable jurisdictions, and if maybe ask Fergus first.
Okay. Okay, so I think my general point earlier was simply that we have a high prison population, both in relation to numbers on remand and in relation to numbers of sentenced prisoners. I think that as was discussed with the previous panel, the reference to the percentage, the 30% figure, is slightly misleading, because that is the product of reducing numbers of sentenced prisoners and rising numbers of remand prisoners. It's probably better to look at the raw data on the numbers that are being remanded, which is rising and has risen precipitously in the past year or two. And then, as was discussed with the previous panel, it's important to dig deeper and look at who's being remanded for what kinds of offences. It is true, as was said in the previous panel, that the numbers of people on remand for violent offences and sexual offences has risen significantly. Other categories have fallen back slightly, but perhaps not as fast as the government might wish in pursuing a reduction in the prison population. That's why I think that's what this bill is trying to do. It's trying to further encourage a reduction in the use of remand for people who don't pose a serious risk to public safety. To me, that's consistent with international standards. It's consistent with conventions and rules that we are subscribed to in the Council of Europe, in the United Nations. It's absolutely the right in principle approach. But I think we need to pay careful attention to the fact that we do have a rise in the number of people remanded in custody for crimes of violence and sexual offences. Even then, though, and this is a question that you might best direct at colleagues in Justice Analytical Services, we need to disaggregate those headings further, because the category crimes of violence is a very broad category in Scotland, and so is the category that's classified as sexual offences. And it's not necessarily the case that every person who is remanded for an index offence, which is categorised as a crime of violence, actually represents a significant risk to public safety. So I think you need analysts, to be honest, to give you the detail on the current remand population, which aspects of it have grown and which aspects of it, which proportions are falling in which categories. And I think I think the bill aims to and would move us in the direction of coming closer into line with comparable European neighbours. I think that's a laudable objective.
And I think we would agree with you on the need for better data. I think that the committee would find that extremely helpful. Hannah, I know that when you spoke initially, you spoke about the need for clarity and more detail in terms of the public interest test in a particular, I suspect, but perhaps more generally. In terms of the question I asked about other European countries or other comparable jurisdictions, are there lessons to be learnt? Because, you know, the aim of the government seems to be to reduce prison numbers and to ensure that, if you like, the most serious offenders are in custody. Bail is obviously given to people who haven't been convicted of anything yet. And I wonder if you think there's lessons to be learned, given that the approach in Scotland does seem quite different from many other European countries in particular.
Yes, so I think the policy intent of the bill, as expressed at a high level, is something that has been fundamentally highlighted as a concern and something needing change since I was a teenager, and I can assure you that I'm not that anymore. So with the Sentencing Commission for Scotland, Audit Scotland, the Scottish Human Rights Commission, the McLeish Report, the Scottish Prisons Commission, an important inquiry held by a previous iteration of this committee there's a fairly well-established consensus that the rates are high and that there could be more community-based responses in Scotland. And given the gravity of the access to justice and the human rights issues involved, tinkering around the edges, elemental changes have not yet produced the substantive change that at least some stakeholders have expressed a desire on. There are three major comparative research studies on bail and remand, two in Europe, I'm holding one of them, and also one in Australia where they've sought to learn what are the insights and the lessons that could be learned from multiple jurisdictions. So this one is from 10 countries. There's another EU-funded one where they tried to look at it across borders, and the Australian one is within Australian jurisdictions. And those often highlight that the legislative levers are one aspect. So limiting the public safety test or expanding or defining the public safety test is one important aspect, and it will impact on judicial decision-making, notwithstanding the importance of their independence and discretion. But these research projects, three major international research projects, also document all the other factors that multiple members of this committee and previous panels of witnesses have said there is in the law, statements such as any material considerations, have good reason, have due regard to. People who are familiar with judicial and court circles will be well aware of why that wording is there. But in practice, the evidence that you have been hearing and will be hearing, and the evidence that these research studies in Europe and Australia have found is that there's a gulf between law and practice, and that the causes of disparities, or as this report by Birkbeck University of London calls it, pre-trial injustice, or questions of the implementation gap, they highlight a series of systemic factors as to how bail reforms or bail law might be applied or misapplied to lead to disproportionate. So if there's a need for a very succinct and well-contextualised supplementary synthesis of these three major studies, as academics would be happy to summarise what our understanding of that is in writing if the committee is interested in that, or at least send through the very credible international research which is pointing to things that are relevant to Scotland and I believe we could be learning from, but not a wholesale import. There will be contextual factors here that are distinctive. And my colleague Leslie is an international authority on what makes Scottish justice distinctive.
I think that would be really useful to hear from her, and I think we'd be grateful for the information that you're referring to. I mean, Leslie, it would be useful to get your thoughts, but also we obviously have to grapple with the black letter of the law. We've got a bill that we'll be looking at, and we need to make sure, if you like, first of all, that we agree with the overriding policy objectives of the Scottish Government. But then if we do agree, the next issue is actually whether what's on this piece of paper that's going to be put before the Parliament is actually going to deliver what it is that they are planning on trying to deliver. And if you have thoughts on that also in terms of whether actually, the words that we are being provided with in this bill are likely to be looked at by the courts and implemented by the courts in the way that the Scottish Government intends.
Yeah, okay. So first of all, to go back to your first question, which was about are there too many people on remand? And there are too many people on remand in Scotland. And this is really important because all the indicators show that crime is falling. It's been falling for a long time. It's fallen by 57% since its peak in the sort of mid-noughties. So crime is dropping, convictions are dropping, everything is going down, and yet imprisonment rates tend to go up and remand rates are going up considerably. A huge increase in remand, particularly over the lockdown, sort of major increase in remand, particularly in summary cases, the numbers in summary cases. As I've said earlier, that over half of the people who put on remand don't end up being sent to custody once they're actually convicted, so that transition is not there. So there's clearly something, there's too many people there. There's always a need for remanding people who are presenting a risk to others. That's absolutely the case. There is a need for this, but it could be considerably smaller and considerably smaller. So that's one thing, particularly in the context of crime dropping. In terms of whether this will all work, one of the great success stories in Scotland has been what's happened in youth justice. The whole system approach in youth justice, which has looked at holistically at how people move through a system and how you can divert people to meaningful alternatives to certain bits of the system, has actually really worked well. We've had a major reduction in convictions among 16 and 17s. It's gone down by 90% if you look at it as a rate of population. Offence referrals to the juvenile justice system to the reporter have gone down massively, around about 83% since the peak in the mid-noughties. And we've seen how that has actually had real and meaningful reductions of people in the system, so that they're ending up with a much smaller group of young people that they can actually work with more effectively. Now, when we look at this bill as a whole, aspects of this are actually leading to a sort of sense of a more holistic and systemic approach to adult justice. We've seen how the Scottish Government wants to have a whole system approach for women offenders as well as young people. We should have it for adult male offenders as well. And that the bail requirements, which is we're going to try and remove people from remand where possible, send them to bail supervision and supervision that might support them and their needs, that can only be a good thing in terms of managing risk if it works, and that if it can actually be made that people do actually end up on bail supervision and not remand, where they don't need to be on remand. And then the through care propositions, which we haven't actually talked about very much, but trying to really manage that reintegrative process for longer term offenders back well into the community, that whole way, but linking in with other bits of the system, that's something that could really, really make a major difference to public safety within Scotland. So I really welcome those dimensions of it, but it's going to need appropriate resourcing. I keep going back to that. It's the resources for me that's the most important thing of this. In terms of the legal aspects of this, I think there needs some more definition around what public safety might be. But in terms of actually how it will work in practice, it is the devil's in the detail in terms of the resource implications. I will go back to that again. I don't know if that helps answer your question.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Jamie, over to you.
Thank you. It's just a follow-on from the conversation we've just had, and I think what one of the difficulties we're having is perhaps a keenness not to equate subjective assumptions or analysis into fact. So it's quite an easy thing to say that there are too many people on remand. That may or may not be true, but that depends on your definition of what is right and what's wrong in terms of remand decisions under the status quo. Is it the case that there are too many people on remand, or is it the case, and I'm throwing it out there, I'm not taking a view, but that there are the right people rightly being held on remand but are wrongfully being held on remand for too long? Because the inevitability of that, due to court backlogs, and we've heard anecdotal evidence of people being held for longer than the end result of their custodial sentence would have been, even after conviction, is that there are simply too many people in prison on remand who should have been released much earlier, because their cases should have been heard much earlier. And that's off the back of the first evidence session that we had. And it's something that I think that Professor McNeil said around the data that goes around this, that it's not just the numbers that you should look at, it's the context and the profile of those who are being held remand and the types of offences that are being held for. So I'm just throwing it out there as a devil's advocate, because it's quite easy to say this phrase, there are too many people on remand, and then it becomes a truth without challenging it. So I'm keen to make sure that we do challenge it.
Maybe I can answer it. In a way, the answer applies equally to part two of the bill. I'm conscious we haven't even got there yet. I think the answer applies. And it also goes back to Russell Finlay's question to Hannah. We're discussing an area of policy here which unavoidably engages normative questions, right? So there is no objective way to say what the size of a prison population should be. You take a view on that depending on whether or not you want Scotland to be a country which complies with international standards in relation to human rights, or you can take a view on that relates to another kind of ideology, and that's fine. You know, there's people can have different views on that. Once you establish principles, then you can ask criminologists to say whether the principles are being applied in a way which is effective or ineffective. And when we get to the evidence portion of our submission, and we're citing all those studies, we're basically arguing about whether or not the goals that have been set for the system are being achieved. Now, if the point of using the criminal justice system, the processing of people through court, is to secure justice or to provide retribution, say, then that leads to a certain conclusion. If it's to provide public safety, that can sometimes point in a contradictory direction. If it's eventually to work for the reintegration of people who have offended, that can also... So that this is a complex system with multiple objectives. Sometimes the normative principles that are being applied and tested here are actually somewhat contradictory or challenge one another. I guess all I can say in response to your question is that I think that in relation to international comparisons and international standards, we have an unusually high prison population and we have an unusually high remand population at a time when we have low crime rates. And not just low recorded crime rates, but also relatively low crime rates reported through victimisation surveys. So the things which are driving our prison population are not crime problems, they're policy choices and established cultures and practices in our system. And I think, and this is an opinion, and a normative opinion grounded in commitment to certain principles which are reflected in international standards, I think that's wrong for Scotland and that we should be trying to change it. I'm sympathetic to the legislation only because I think it points in the right direction, although I agree with some of the lines of questioning that some of the ways in which it seeks to do that need to be ironed out and clarified. But
it's interesting because based on what you said and the way that you said it, one would assume if we talk about overall crime reducing, yet prison population going up, yet if we look at the period from when policy decisions did lead to legislative change, for example, presumption against short sentences, which you mentioned in a previous answer, in the year that the presumption against short sentences was passed, there were 68,000 violent crimes, and I know that's a very wide category, but under the exact same definition, last year that number had risen to 69,000. Over the same period, their prison population fell from 8,400, just to check the numbers, 8,200 down to 7,400. So despite a rise in certain types of perceived to be more serious crimes, our prison population has actually been reducing. So, I mean, it's very difficult. I know you can divvy up statistics in a number of ways to get what you want out of them, but and it does lead to the importance of proper statistical and data analysis, which I think we have been severely lacking and probably still are some massive gaps in that, because that may help inform some of the decisions that we make moving forward. Does anyone have anything to add, or have I covered that issue quite well? No problem. The only one is an interesting question. I appreciate you've made your views clear that you think that it's completely appropriate for legislation to narrow the grounds in which bail can be refused, or to use legislation as a mechanism to do that. But equally, I think it's interesting, you do also state that that cannot be done in isolation, that some of the views that have been expressed around the conditions around bail and the services around bail could be improved, but equally access to public services for those who are released on bail, that has to happen alongside that. And I thought maybe I'd explore that perhaps with you, Hannah, because I think it's easy just to focus on the bail aspect, which is all the bill does actually, and it doesn't in any great way meaningfully address any of the other perceived failings in the system, which some may perhaps on the victims' organisations would feel would be necessary alongside this type of intervention.
Yes, indeed. And also it doesn't... something that I know that members here care about is it doesn't necessarily help address the reasons that continue to see people breaching bail conditions, which in some cases are harm and alleged offence related or crime specific, but in other cases I was reading the committee's inquiry report into the use of remand in 2018, and my colleague Neil Hutton's small-scale study on the reasons for bail refusal, and then some of the rhetoric that we see coming through in comments from the judiciary and fiscals and also in research, where there can be low-level sort of repeated things that might produce reoffending, but at a low level that's not as serious as some of the sensitive things that we've already heard about. But something that inquiry report, Neil's research, which he presented as evidence to the committee at that point, the McLeish report of the Scottish Prisons Commission, very much emphasises that in order to tackle and better support and respond to some of these issues, it's going to take a multidisciplinary, multi-sectoral approach. So a phrase that comes through commonly is that the individual had a chaotic lifestyle. The tenacity of commitment of this committee to understanding things like trauma and drug-related issues and harms, you can call it a chaotic lifestyle, but people who are failing to do things that they've been reasonably required to do, it may be alleged offence-related reasons, it may also be poverty, health, welfare, social care, things that need a range of support. That's not to condone those issues, but to say compliance could be much better supported with the multidisciplinary aspect so that we can avoid what the McLeish Commission or the Scottish Prisons Commission called the warehousing problem and the remand problem, where it's warehousing a place to hold the damaged and traumatised for problematic and largely unnecessary use of prison. Fergus was an advisor to that commission, and I believe it's held in very wide and well regard across professions, across perhaps different ideological or normative positions. And so I draw attention to the qualitative research by our colleagues. Emily Tweed and colleagues has pointed to the fact that if remand is used, it could result in much more acute mental health distress. I know that members are concerned around the use of custody where remand is implicated in a higher risk of self-inflicted death by drug overdose or by suicide. And so getting to grips with not only the statistics and the reality, but also implicating that it's going to take health and social care, employment, unemployment, housing, homelessness, bailed to what? Early released or reintegrated to what? And it's certainly not something that I would expect this committee to have to solve on your own. Your other committees will need to have due regard to the health, welfare, social issues that are coming through and whether they are being adequately met by the provisions in the bill, but also in the resourcing of the multidisciplinary services, because we very much have an empathy and a passion for fewer victims in future. I don't want us to be having this conversation, the same conversation in 18 years' time, like we have been doing for the last 18 years.
Thanks, Convener. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. We have well run over, but I think this has been a really important and valuable session. I would like to just finish with one question, and if I can ask for answers to be fairly succinct. As you were saying, Fergus, we've really kind of found it difficult to move off bail, but I would just like to ask a little bit about release planning and through care support that you have touched on. So if I can maybe come to yourself, Fergus, first, with the aim of supporting the successful reintegration of prisoners back into the community, the bill includes provisions on release planning and standards of through care support. In your view, are the proposals in the bill helpful, and what, if any, changes you would like to see in the provisions outlined? So I'll start with you, Fergus, and then come to Leslie.
Big question and difficult to answer briefly, but I'll really try hard. So, yes, I think the measures are helpful. I think anything which enables progression through the custodial part of a sentence to the completion of a sentence in the community is to be welcomed. And I think that as with bail, and actually as with bail supervision and support, we cannot underestimate the complexity of the task of supporting people in those transitions, whether it's instead of going into remand or whether it's coming out. potentially from a longer prison sentence. People need support in a huge range of areas. There's some recent research undertaken at Glasgow University by Alejandro Rubio Arnal, which looked at post-prison reintegration in Glasgow, used a dialogical method of inquiry with a whole group of people with different forms of experience, lived experience, practice experience, professional experience, and academic experience, and he argued in conclusion that reintegration has six key facets that have to be addressed. People need material reintegration, that's about basic subsistence, housing, access to public assistance if they need it until they can get work, assistance with personal development, developing the skills and capacities to live well in the community, legal reintegration in terms of restoration of a person's legal status, and that relates to the question of how we deal with criminal records in this country, which I think is often problematic in terms of allowing people access to the labour market, civic and political participation, including in the political life of our country, which we're, I think, not necessarily good at supporting in disadvantaged communities generally, but in particular people that are processed through our criminal justice system are generally very much politically disenfranchised. There's moral reintegration, which relates to the restoration of relationships with communities and with victims, or at least mediation of those relationships. And then finally, there's social reintegration, which is about acceptance and belonging in a community and about dealing with the stigmatisation that people face as they try to move on from imprisonment, from involvement with criminal justice, from problematic substance use. In all of those interlinked contexts, people are hamstrung in their efforts to change themselves and transform their lives by the reactions of people around them. So to support that transition for people in, through and out of prison, and to support that for people who are bailed instead of being remanded, is no small thing. So there are huge resource implications. I think everybody's made that clear. One thing I'll say, though, to finish, the money exists. The money's locked up with people in prison. And if we want money to make these systems work effectively, then we need political courage to get the money out of jail along with the people. Unless, as politicians, you believe that there is a magic money tree to shake, in which case, shake it and spend it on reintegration. As a criminologist, actually setting aside normative questions, I have no hesitation in arguing that on the available evidence, imprisonment is a shockingly bad public investment when it comes to reoffending and reintegration, and therefore the longer term pursuit of public safety. So I think thinking hard about how we get our money, and it is our money, out of jails and into communities should be at the heart of the reform efforts that we're discussing today, not just the technical legal reforms on the face of this bill, but the kind of wider project of developing a more evidence-based, progressive and coherent penal policy in Scotland that complies with international standards.
Thank you very much. Leslie, if it's remotely feasible to give me a succinct answer to that question, but I'll bring you in.
Yeah, so, I mean, I agree with things that Fergus have said. That could be a succinct answer. I think that I really welcome the, there is a very robust research evidence base to support the better reintegration and a focus on reintegration for long-term prisoners that the bill is trying to enable, that the robust evidence base would support efforts to make that process smoother and more supportive, because that would actually lead to greater enhanced public safety. I think that at the moment, the getting rid of through care support offices within prisons, I think, has been unfortunate. And I think the kind of pre-release preparation within prisons could be very much more enhanced, particularly as it relates to the integration with the community-based dimensions of supervision and support. So the sort of the suggestions for this new licence to be created, I think, is a very good one. I think the issues about people being reintegrated into the community, it's hugely challenging for people. Results of our research from the Edinburgh Study of Youth Transitions and Crime, which has been tracking this cohort for 4,300 people who are now in their mid-30s, we'll be tracking them, that the research evidence from that shows the complex needs of people. It reinforces other research that's been done around drugs, around the need for relationship building, around the need to support resistance from offending, to support relationship building, to support mental health issues people have. The complex needs that they have needs a kind of complex set of resources within the community that are not always there at the moment, particularly things around sort of mental community, mental health support, for example, about adequate housing, a whole range of things that they need. Therefore, there has to be very careful planning. There has to be good central decision making and leadership around that decision making, how you can actually support and mobilise services, and particularly for justice social work, a need to recognise that actually the things that really make a difference to people who are on licence are the relationships with the key worker. We know this from our research about the continuity, about good relationships, advocacy and support and empowerment for people. Those are the things that really make a difference, and that is, needs time, it needs well-trained staff, it needs nurtured staff, it needs well-paid staff. So actually putting resource, transferring resource from jailing people into community justice and the mobilised services that they need to support people is actually would, in fact, be a tough way of dealing with crime in Scotland. It would enhance public safety. And so I really support the intentions of the bill in terms of that integrative approach.
Thank you very much indeed. And on that note, I'd like to thank all our panel members today. We could probably speak for another couple of hours on this. Thank you very much indeed. We'll just have a very short suspension to allow our panel members to leave. Thank you. Thank you very much, members. The next agenda item is consideration of legislative consent issues for the UK Government's Public Order Bill, and I refer members to Paper 3. Now, you'll see that the relevant provision in the bill is to extend powers similar to those currently held by Police Scotland to British Transport Police in Scotland for the policing of protests on railway land. And the Scottish Government is recommending legislative consent be given to this provision. So I'm happy now to open up the discussion to members, and then we will consider what recommendation we want to make to Parliament on legislative consent. So do any members have any queries or questions? No? Okay, thank you very much. The question is, does the committee agree with the Scottish Government that the Scottish Parliament should consent to the relevant provisions in this bill as set out in the Scottish Government's draft motion? Are you happy? Thank you very much. And are members content to delegate to me the publication of a short report that summarises the outcome of our deliberations on the LCM? Thank you. So the issue will now move to the Chamber for all members to decide based on our report. Okay, thank you very much. So our next agenda item is to consider an update to our action plan. This item was delayed from our previous meeting. In the spirit of time, I would ask members if they are happy for us to, rather than consider page by page the action plan today, if you have specific additions, queries or amendments that you would like to be made to the action plan, if you would let the clerk's team know and we can come back to the action plan at a future meeting. Are members in agreement to that? Russell?
What would the timescale for that be? Would the clerks need to know if there's anything?
Clerks?
Don't really have a specific timetable, Deputy Convener. You could send it over the next few days, but at your leisure, because I'm not sure when we'll be able to reschedule the action plan given the amount of evidence you've got coming up over the next week or two. So we've got a reasonable time frame for any responses.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. You happy with that?
Thank you. Yep.
Jamie?
Yeah, it's just briefly to add that I think essentially what we're doing is ditching it from today's agenda because we're out of time, but I don't think that means it should completely go offline. Yeah. I think it's the sort of thing, because it's one of the few documents that we do share quite widely with the public and stakeholders on progress that we're making as a committee. It's something that we should revisit, probably in quite deep, great detail, but we would need to forward at proper time. I would rather do that than simply just become a paper trail of correspondence between members and the clerks. For a purpose of update, we should have an open public session on it so that people can follow what we're saying. So,
yeah, I agree. And just for clarification, I would intend that where we can bring it back onto the agenda, we absolutely will. I agree. I don't want it just to be a bit of email correspondence from now on in. OK. Thank you very much. So our next agenda item is to consider correspondence from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans on the issues of virtual trials and on the current practice of charging for court transcripts. And I refer members to paper 5. And I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for his letter. So firstly, in relation to the use of virtual trials, I should just point out and remind members that the committee recognises that the use of virtual trials is already provided for in the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Act of 2022. However, despite this and the practice note that was issued by the Lord Justice General, very few fully virtual trials have been held, and the committee has been keen to see more take place, particularly in relation to cases of rape and serious sexual offences. So the question remains, how can we see more of these types of trials in order to build up an evidence base to inform whether they could become an option for prosecution of appropriate sexual offences cases? And secondly, on the issue of the charging, of the current practice of charging for court transcripts, I also welcome the Cabinet Secretary's comments. And I note to support in principle, however, he does refer in his correspondence to the possibility that further consultation could be required. Now, members will recall that we have written to the Cabinet Secretary previously on this issue, as we're keen that it is considered prior to the introduction of the forthcoming Criminal Justice Reform Bill, to enable us to consider such a provision as part of the scrutiny of the forthcoming bill, which could provide a suitable legislative opportunity to resolve this issue. So there's a bit in there. So do members firstly have any comments that they wish to make on the matter of the virtual trials, first of all? So Russell, then Colette.
So about halfway through the letter, the last paragraph, the first page, we learn that these virtual summary domestic abuse trials have been taking place for about 3 years, and the Cabinet Secretary tells us that this has been at the direction of the Lord Justice Clerk, which all makes perfect sense. But I'm somewhat surprised when you read further that he goes on to say, if we want to know how many have actually taken place, he doesn't appear to have this information. Scottish Government don't appear to have that information, and I find that quite surprising. And I think we've already had a bit of to and fro already, and it shouldn't be this difficult, I don't think, to get such basic data, because I think there's been some anecdotal suggestion that the numbers are very, very small. And he goes on to say in the following paragraph that these powers run for the next 10 months and then they expire, but they can be extended until 2025. So in the one breath we're talking about we don't have basic data, and the next breath we're talking about extending without that basic data. It's just really poor. In respect of the transcripts, I feel like, again, we've been kind of battered about a little bit. We've not had a very clear explanation from anyone as to how much this costs. My understanding is a private company provides this service. One thing that struck me about Parliament is how quickly transcribed debates are online. It's incredibly efficient. And I'm not saying that the courts could do it easily or without cost, but we've not really had an explanation as to why it can't be done properly. So.
Thank you. Colette.
Thanks. I would just be keen to see the consultation response that's coming out. It says in these responses that it's going to be published in due course in order to make a more informed choice. I'd be really keen to see that response. And I note as well that the research that's been carried out by University of Glasgow and Ipsy Mori as well. So I think, I think that'll give us more information in terms of virtual trials as well. And what the public considers and the questions that have been put forward as well on that.
Okay. Thank you. Jamie, and then Rona.
Yeah, I'll try and keep it brief. I actually welcome the opening position of the Cabinet Secretary, where he says that a greater evidence base should be developed before they are made a permanent feature of Scotland's justice system. And by they, I mean fully virtual trials. He says, I continue to agree with that approach. I actually agree with his agreement of that approach. But I do also share the concern made by a colleague that we are being passed back to the SCTS for data on what something that has been taking place for 3 years. It seems unusual for the government not to have kept a watching brief on it or to have the data that we asked of them. Nonetheless, if the STS have that data, let's ask them for it and for a report back to us on use of the use of virtuality within trials or fully virtual trials themselves. Because again, we are living off the back of other legislation of which this was part of, not full legislation which deals with fully virtual trials. I think there'd be a lot of interest in it, both from what many stakeholders, not just those victims organisations who are clear proponents of the use, further use of it in certain types of trials, but those who have reservations about it as well. And I feel like I don't really know what the end goal is here. Is there a plan within government to move to some form of permanence, either in law or otherwise, or simply just say these are matters for the courts and not for us to intervene on? So I feel like we're a little bit in limbo with that. And whilst I look forward to the consultation responses being published, I don't think that will necessarily answer that question as to what the government's plans are. And I think on the issue of transcripts, it's a perennial issue where we seem to be going round in circles on it, asking for resolution, but the government's pushing back. that they just keep saying there are several matters that we need to consider. Well, we know there are several matters. We've been talking about it for a year now. So I would like to hope that 2023 is the year of resolution. And one resolution might be we get to the bottom of this court transcript issue, because as Russell Finlay rightly said, we managed to transcribe 22 hours of quite robust chamber debate in a matter of 48 hours. If it can be done here, I'm sure it can be done in courts.
Okay, thank you very much. Rona, yes.
I mean, Katie. I broadly agree with what Jamie Green's been saying. I think it's really important that we know what the situation is with virtual trials and we have that data, actually. Can I ask, when was the last time we asked the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service for that information? Because I can't remember.
Yeah, so we, during the coronavirus recovery bill consideration, that would have been earlier this year.
Earlier last year.
Yes, last year, 2022. Yeah. Yes, it would have been then.
Yeah. I mean, I would suggest that we contact them again and stress that it's really important that we know. I mean, they obviously know, and we need to know that too, I think. Yeah. And on the court transcripts thing, you know, again, I don't know when the last time we asked for that was, and clearly we've been referred back to the SCTS, but, we need to press them on that as well. It's not that they're not doing it, presumably, as, you know, it is being done. It's just that we don't have access to it. So... Yeah.
Okay, Katie, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I mean, on transcripts, I suspect one of the issues is cost, but I really think we should be provided with that information. I mean, it's a huge amount of the committee's time that we're spending talking and asking about this, and there doesn't seem to be a willingness to share information. I mean, on the virtual trials, I think we'll all remember that we discussed this at length during the bill. And we asked repeatedly for the kind of information that Rona's talking about, and it wasn't really forthcoming. It took us an awful lot of time to get any information, and I think our conclusion was actually that far less was happening than was being presented, and I suspect that's still the case. But I think as a committee, what we'd be concerned about is that, you know, we're going to be sort of bounced into making permanent decisions when the evidence base isn't there. So I think we should actually be quite robust in terms of our correspondence with the Cabinet Secretary, outlining that history and saying that it's not that in principle we would have an objection, but that it does need to be evidenced and it needs to be subject to democratic scrutiny, given the serious and considerable implications for the justice system. So whether we do that now or whether we do that at a later stage, I do think we want to put that in writing, really going back as to why it is that we're asking for this information.
You want to come back in, Jamie?
I'm not sure it's appropriate to intervene in someone making a comment, but I felt that it was very relevant. And it's not just about the volume or quantity or scale of trials that seem to be fully virtual, it was actually about the outcomes of them, because that's the other side of the data that was far more useful in some ways. And I think that's the piece of data that we were missing during the passing of the previous legislation, because the volume in itself is superfluous if you don't know what effect that's having on outcomes, which may address some of the issues that people have around it. So I think it's that sort of level of data that we need to see.
The evidence we did get from the pilot was that a very small number of cases had gone ahead, but actually there was a very high number of acquittals, that there was far more people found not guilty than we would normally have expected. Now, it was a very small sample, so I don't think you could really take much of that, but actually the evidence that we've had, particularly in domestic abuse cases, was that it was actually leading to more people being found innocent rather than more people being found guilty, which is perhaps what the concern had been, that was that actually the accused wouldn't get a fair trial. So if anything, the evidence that we've had is surprising and would mean that we'd need even more information, I think, before making any decisions. So I think it just, you know, what Jamie's saying is reinforces the fact that, you know, I think we need to lay down a marker that we wouldn't agree to permanent changes unless the evidence base is there, and that we would want that over a period of time, because these are permanent changes which potentially could have major implications in cases. Mm-hmm.
Okay, did you want to come back in,
Bill? Quickly, in response to what Colette said about the two ongoing bits of research. One of them specifies there's a date, which is spring this year, for the Ipsos Mori one. Yep. The other one just says in due course, which is perhaps worth seeking some clarity. Yes. That's in relation to the issue at hand, the summary trials. Just get a bit of a steer from them, could be useful.
Okay, that's fine. Okay, thank you. Okay, thanks very much. I concur with the kind of views that have been expressed. I do think it would be helpful for us to go back and seek up-to-date data from SCTS on the numbers of fully virtual trials since we had the last figures, which is probably coming up for a year ago, when we were looking at the coronavirus legislation. So happy to take that away on behalf of members. I think in relation to some of the concerns that were raised around the role of defence agents in opposing virtual trials, and despite the practice note that has been issued by the Lord Justice Clerk, I think there's perhaps an opportunity for us to maybe ask the Lord Justice Clerk why, despite the practice note that was issued, the practical reality is there seems to be very few trials taking place. And finally, in relation to the comments made around the Cabinet Secretary, I wonder if members would be in agreement that we perhaps ask the Cabinet Secretary if he would refer to the Justice Board and the governance group that's overseeing Lady Dorrien's report to get a bit more clarity on why there are still very few virtual trials, despite the fact that there is a provision for them. So would members be in agreement to take these tasks away, Rona?
I'm just wondering about the chronological order of that. So if we're going to ask the SCTS how many trials they've done, should we not wait till we get that information and then contact the Cabinet Secretary?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, I agree. And on the matter of court transcripts, again, I agree with what members have raised. I'm happy to propose that we perhaps clarify with the Cabinet Secretary if indeed there is a plan to undertake a consultation on the proposals in advance of the introduction of the Criminal Justice Law Reform Bill, or is what he has outlined in his letter referring to the fact that it might be done sometime in the future, but there's a bit of lack of clarity about timescales. I'm quite keen that we maybe get some more detail on that too. Members happy with that? Yep. Okay, thank you very much indeed. Okay. On that note, I think that completes our final business in public, and we now move into private session. Thank you.